right. Welcome, everybody, tonight from Hurricane Stadium here in beautiful Hurricane, Utah. My name is Keith Curtis. I'm here with Paul Valenzuela, the ex-Weber State Wildcat.
That's right. Go Cats.
That's right. Go Cats. The Tigers are a cat,
so yeah, we'll definitely be rooting for them tonight because they're closer to the home team. So
that's right. That's right. We're here tonight as Hurricane takes on Moapa Valley High School. And if you're wondering where Moapa is from, it is in between Mesquite and Las Vegas. And they're in, I believe it's Overton /
directly at the corner of No and Where.
I told Paul to save some of those for when we get on the air, so that was classic. Thank you.
Yeah,
I'm not going there because I know some of the hate mail that comes through later after the game,
yeah,
Paul.
No, I go by there. It's the cruise control set at 85 as I go by, so I know it's there, but haven't stopped much.
This is the pregame show sponsored by House of Jump. Purchase 1 hour jump time Monday through Thursday. I mentioned this ad and get $10 in the arcade just for free. Paul, we got a great matchup here tonight. It's Moapa Valley's first game of the year. They did not play last week. And Hurricane, they did play. They went on the road and they took on the Mustangs up in Hiram, Utah. And unfortunately, it was not a good Friday night for the Tigers. In fact, it was so not a great game. They didn't even post their stats from the game. So we don't have a lot to really dwell on as far as, you know, last week's game for them. But we've got a few key guys that we know that Coach Ashby's leaning on. And so we've got a few things that we can talk about. But what are your initial thoughts? This is your initial broadcast with us tonight, Paul. What do you, a little excitement in the stomach again?
Yeah, absolutely. I've been around football for 50 years this year, so it's this is my first time doing this, but excited to do it. Just the things that you told us about Coach Ashby, what I was looking at, the key 8 or 10 guys that he called out for us are guys that are underclassmen, sophomores and juniors. So hopefully they went to school at Mountain Crest last week, and they, you know, they always say that you do your most improving between game one and game two. Hopefully that'll happen for a lot of these young guys. For a lot of them, it was probably their first time playing varsity football.
Yeah.
The speed of the game was all over them, and they kind of got overwhelmed. So hopefully at home, in front of their home crowd, in front of their parents, didn't have that long bus ride to Cache County, so they'll respond and play better than they did last week. And then Moapa, we don't know anything about them because this is their first crack out. So
yeah, last year we just hit on Moapa Valley. I know that I heard they went 9-2 in their league, so they had a really good season. I did hear they graduated a bunch of seniors, so it'll be interesting to see how they come out and play tonight. But you mentioned for Hurricane, there's a lot of youth there. And as you said, the speed of the game, there's nothing like trying to assimilate that in practice.
Yeah.
Because you just can't do it unless you have, you know, 100 guys that you can filter through the program. And a Hurricane doesn't have that. So it's, you know, it's a learning experience. It's going to be, I'm sure we'll see some learning tonight. But for right now, it looks like we're going to have the national anthem here. So we'll take a quick break here on our pregame show sponsored by House of Jump, and we'll take a 2-minute timeout and we'll be right back.
Relatives coming to visit, not enough room, or maybe you're looking to host a family reunion and need a house with a pool? Well, Red Rock Vacation Rentals has got you covered. From 2-bedroom condos to 10-bedroom luxury homes, they truly have something for everyone. Plan your perfect getaway or staycation. Visit stgeorgeutahvacationrentals.com.
Scooter's Coffee and Hurricane is the best way to start your day or get you through your day. From breakfast sandwiches to cinnamon rolls to amazing smoothies and, of course, coffee, anytime is a good time to sip and smile Scooter's Coffee. Open 7 days a week.
All right, we're back here at Hurricane Stadium, home of the Tigers. And tonight we've got the Moapa Valley Pirates taking on the Hurricane Tigers. We are about 6 minutes away from kickoff. And, Paul, let's talk about some of the the key guys that we want to probably keep an eye out or an ear out to here tonight as we're streaming live on the Fan Sports Network as well as on the radio. So, Paul, any thoughts or who are key guys maybe from Moapa first? Let's talk about them first. What do you know?
Well, just from watching them in the warm-ups, the offense looks like it runs through number 9, this Talent Schraft, junior, so he looks to be pretty talented, runs well. What I saw in the warm-ups, a lot of just regular twin sets, motion. They'll try to run some inside counter and stuff to get some misdirection. They look pretty good. Of course, in warm-ups, you don't see the defensive guys play, but you would know about that being a D lineman. So they look good. They look crisp. Not a lot of size on the offensive line, so it'll be interesting to see how they match up front with what Hurricane has to offer.
Yeah, they did. We were watching them in warmups, as you mentioned, and it looks like Schraft. He moves really well. Throws the ball on a rope, and looks like he can move it around a little bit. Another guy I heard that will play running back as well as slot is number 1, Shandon Matheson. He's a 5'8 senior running back. Want to keep an eye on him. I'm sure we'll mention his name a lot. Another key guy is Tanner Hammonds. He's a senior wide receiver. He's a taller kid at 6'2". And then on defense, he's got a couple of middle linebackers that Coach Lewis told me to look out for. He said number 50, Ryan Belevant. He's one to look out for, as well as Gavin Frederick. He's another middle linebacker. Belevance is a senior, and Frederick is just a junior. So a couple of main guys there for us to keep an eye on. I'm sure you'll hear tonight throughout the broadcast. But we are now ready for the presentation of the colors. So we will take another quick break here in the House of Jump pregame show. We'll be back in 1 minute right after this.
Welcome to the Boulevard Home Game of the Week on the Fans Sports Network.
Punishing runner.
Into the end zone, touchdown.
Big hole up the middle. 15, 10, 5, touchdown.
For a touchdown.
See Hearst first this month for great deals on red hot buys at Hearst Ace Hardware. Make sure and get an Ace Rewards card for savings around the house, the yard, or the job site. Stop by Hearst General Store Ace Hardware, conveniently located in the heart of downtown Cedar City and St. George.
I'm Bo Bradshaw, owner of Bo's Auto Parts. I want to watch the game as well, so I'll make this quick. When you come into Bo's Auto Parts, our store mission is simple. Supply our customers with the best auto parts and the best customer service we can provide. Come on by and see if we can deliver.
From your very first investment to your passage from one stage of life into the next, we're here. Through all of your firsts, U First Credit Union is here for you. Come grow with us.
Nets on Fire is the premier indoor basketball training facility in Southern Utah, with 4 full-size gyms and group and individual training packages available for every age and skill level. Nets on Fire can elevate your game. Hoop it, Nets!
All right, we're back live here at Tiger Stadium in Hurricane, Utah. Tonight we got the Hurricane Tigers taking on the Moapa Valley Pirates from Overton, Nevada. We just had a beautiful rendition of the Stars and Stripes, and we're about 3 minutes away from kickoff. So, Paul, who are some key guys on the Hurricane side that our listeners at home can be on the lookout for tonight?
Everything's going to run through their quarterback. Isn't that Brendan? Is mm-hmm. that Hoffman?
Brendan. Yep, that's right, Brendan Hoffman.
So you know, you always talk about the quarterbacks because they're the key guy. They also have a running back, Pledger, that's supposed to be pretty good. So we'll look out for him. And then if we look for their big guys, number 51, Titan Wright. I think he plays both ways, so we should see number 51 a lot too.
Yeah, some other guys that Coach Ashby mentioned that maybe some newcomers to the starting offense this year. Offensive line, Andrew Muggleston. He's just a young sophomore, but he'll be on the line starting. That's some valuable varsity experience. Anytime you can start as a sophomore, that's a great opportunity. He also has got another sophomore on the line, Matt Perry. And then he's got a wide receiver that's a sophomore, C.J. Trump. So we mentioned that a lot of youth that is on this Hurricane team. So it's going to be interesting to see, like you said, up front, how will they match up with some of the size that Moapa Valley might have. And based on what we saw earlier, I think it's going to be a pretty evenly matchup as far as up front goes. I think it'll come down to scheme and some of the athleticism from the skill guys.
Yeah, I'm hoping that it's a good game up front so that we can see the skill guys play and hopefully play well. So it's matchups, and on paper it looks like we should have a good contest, so that makes it more exciting, more fun to watch. So,
well, last year I know Hurricane went down to Moapa Valley and they lost by, I think it was a field goal, so it was a really close game. So I expect it'll probably be a lot like last year. It should be within a one-score ball game. And with Hurricane being at home this year, and I wouldn't be surprised they end up pulling it off tonight. So that'd be great for the home crowd.
It's good. I hope so. One of the other things that that we didn't talk about is taking care of the ball. So the turnover battle could be key. In a close game, turnovers matter.
Yeah.
So whichever team takes care of the ball and doesn't turn it over, especially those key turnovers deep in your territory or scoop and score, pick six kind of things, can really change the momentum in a close game. So we got to keep an eye out for that because that could be a determining factor in this game too.
Yeah, it sure can. And as you mentioned, you got younger guys that aren't used to maybe being hit by a senior, you know. That could always come end up being a problem. So both teams are now warmed up. We're about 10 seconds away here. I didn't happen to see the coin flip. Did you happen to see that?
It looks like they're just getting ready to go do it right now. The captains are out there ready to go.
Here I am thinking I missed something, but thank goodness I didn't. So that's good. They'd definitely get rid of me if that were the case, Paul.
Number 70 here, that's one of Hurricane's captains, looks like he can. He's a big fella. He could really do some work.
That's 2-A for Hurricane. He played last year. He was a key contributor on last year's line. So he definitely has some size. He's got some good hair too, coming out of the back of that helmet.
Yeah, I'm a little jealous, but there was a time.
I remember. Yeah, you and I kind of have the same haircut going on here.
We don't have to talk about the 80s mullets. That's
you know, I asked someone last year, is he related, he being 2-A, to the big offensive lineman that played for the Cowboys? You know, that 2-A. I think he played for the Cowboys, and they said no, but they said they'd certainly take some of his money, though.
That's true. You always claim him.
Yeah, really. Well, I think you had some really good keys to the game tonight. As you mentioned, turnovers will be a factor, especially if they're, you know, deep in their own territory. And I had the fortune of calling the Crimson Morgan game last week, and there was a couple of interceptions as always. Pretty clean game for the most part. Not a lot of flags, and you usually see in the first week or two a lot of penalties. So, be interested to see how Moapa Valley comes out, if that comes a problem, or even if there's any carryover for Hurricane tonight. So we'll definitely be on the lookout for that.
Yeah, especially early on with Moapa, this is their first game, so things false start, delay of games, mental mistakes, again, is another one of those things that can put you behind. You know, first and 15 instead of first and 10 is a huge difference, and especially for young guys that are trying to figure it out. So those are things to watch for early on, is just to see who's a little more engaged mentally and who's ready to play, and we're ready to play. So they got the coin toss is over. It looks like Moapa won. It looks like they won the toss and deferred, and
Hurricane's going
to get the ball. Is that right?
Yeah, Hurricane's going to go north to south on our screen here. And so they'll get the ball first. And so the opening kickoff will be here in just a second. Let us just give a quick shout-out to some of our sponsors throughout tonight's broadcast. We've got Finley Subaru, Fabulous Freddy's, Bucks Ace Hardware. They're all sponsors of our Inside Region 9 tailgate and recap shows. We also have Team D Auto, who's a Keys to the Game sponsor. Our timeout sponsor is UD & Associates, Red Rock Real Estate, Holbrook Asphalt, Jason Baum. Paul, you're going to have to keep me in line and keep track of the Jason Baum of the game.
Okay.
We also have Tint World, Wilkinson's House of Lighting. Scooter's Coffee is our sack sponsor, and they got a lot of love last week as Crimson's defense. I think they had like 9 sacks last week, but they're a local coffee shop right down here locally on Main Street here in Hurricane. So we're happy to have them as a sponsor.
I saw them as I came into town tonight.
Yeah, they're a great sponsor, and they love their high school athletics. And we've got sponsorships from Cedar City all the way down. So we just appreciate all of our sponsors and all the contributions that they do for us to be able to stream these games and broadcast these games for you at home.
I think we got that coin toss backwards. Maybe it was Hurricane that won and deferred because they're kicking off. So.
Well, that's the first mistake we've made all night.
We were a long ways away from that coin toss, so we couldn't see the coin.
Well, we got number 11, Lincoln Langston. He is a sophomore for Hurricane. He is set to put this one in the air. He approaches the ball, and we are underway here at Tiger Stadium as this one bounces.
That ball had eyes. Looked like it went through the end zone to me.
Yeah, I think it caught the corner of the end zone, so Moapa Valley, they'll
get they threw the flag.
Oh, they did.
Must have, that's the on the far side, so hard for us to see, so.
Boy, it looked like it caught the corner there, I thought.
Yeah, that's what I thought, but.
Well, that'll bring out the Pirates from Moapa Valley at quarterback. They have number 9, Talon Traft. He is a junior. And in the backfield, they have number 1. It looks like that's Shannon Matheson. Number 12, Mateo Bradshaw at running back. As they break the huddle. They go twins to the left. As he Traft calls out the play, it's a swing pass out to Matheson, who avoids one tackler and picks up 8 yards. So a good start for the Pirates.
Yeah, and it's nice to get a throw early. I mean, that's first varsity play for them. Have a little success early on is good for their quarterback.
Yeah, you get 8-9 yards just like that. That's always a confidence booster. And for Hurricane, they're going to have to regroup a little bit, but it's only one play. As they break the huddle, they go, again, twins to the right side this time, and they go an offset line almost on the left side. But then they shift both tight ends to the right side, so they're going heavy on the right side. Traft holds on, hands off to number 12, Mateo.
Nice.
And he stood up.
That was that inside counter that we saw him trying early on, and that defensive end stayed home and kept his leverage, got inside, made the tackle. So now
was that number 16 that made that tackle? That
yes.
Was Curtis Barlow.
First key third down of the game right now.
Boy, this could be huge if you're a Hurricane fan, if he could make a stop right here. Yeah, that was a great stop by Barlow, keeping him short of that first down marker. We're just taking a quick replay there and brought to you by Holbrook Asphalt. So now it looks like they're resetting the 30-second clock. Got a little clock, quick on the clock here from the hometown team. Traft is in the shotgun. That's a direct snap, this time to number 1. That's to Shannon Matheson, and he just picks his way, kind of a wildcat formation, and yeah. Off the right side, picks up 6 yards for a first down.
Well, you give yourself an extra blocker by having the quarterback being there to throw a block, so that's a nice power play.
That brings up first and 10 from the 48-yard line. So the Pirates are driving here. They go one to the right and one to the left. Again, they go heavy on the right side of the line with one running back in the backfield, and then there's a whistle.
Number five lined up offsides on Hurricane. Drew Larson. The guy was the receiver to this side was off the ball, and he went up right on him in press coverage and was lined up a yard offside.
Larson, he's a young sophomore for the Tigers, playing DB out there, and probably just got a little too much energy flowing. You know, the juices are flowing. He wanted to make a big play. The guy goes in motion, jumps offside. So that'll bring up a first and five from the 43-yard line of Hurricane for the Pirates. They go twins left, and they take both tight ends, and they move them to the right side. Here's the handoff to Matheson. He goes right side, cuts upfield, gets about 8 yards, makes a couple of Tigers miss. So a nice run there for another Pirate first down.
Yeah, so far in this first drive, Matheson's been as advertised, and his Birkin doesn't seem to have an answer for him yet. So
yeah, they're going to have to do something to try to slow down this run game right now with the Pirates. So yeah. Go ahead, Paul.
I was going to say, they're just zone blocking up front. They need to be a little stouter. Their Hurricanes got them outsized. They just need to be a little tougher.
So Schraft comes to the line. He's in shotgun. He's got the running back flanked to his left. And he does a hard count.
Another free 5 yards.
And it looks like number 16, that is Curtis Barlow. He jumps offside for Hurricanes. So like you said, that's 5 free yards. And that'll bring up first and five again from the 27-yard line of Hurricanes.
My father-in-law, who's a Hall of Fame Utah coach, I can't tell you how many times he called no play in the huddle because he knew that these young, anxious players would jump off sides and give you first and five. So that was one of the best plays that we ran when I was helping him coach at South Summit 100 years ago.
Just a good hard count, huh?
Yep.
Here's Schraft in the gun. He fakes the handoff, rolls to his left, and kind of shovel passes it out to the big tight end, number 8, that's Branson Romero, and he gets a first down to the 18-yard line. So second pass completed on this drive for another first down for the Pirates.
A really nice touch by Traff on that to move to his left and get his shoulders back square to the line and make that, like you said, a little shovel pass.
Yeah, he almost didn't wind up on it. Yeah. He just kind of flipped it out there, almost Patrick Mahomes-like. Yeah.
Running to your left and getting that throw accurate is the important thing, and he was able to do that.
Well, the key thing was that he got his shoulders squared.
Got his shoulders squared to the line of scrimmage and got the ball to him. So.
Yeah. So the Pirates here on first down, they go shotgun again. Here's the handoff to number 12, who cuts it up. Phil, he's got a big hole, breaks the tackles, dragging some Tiger defenders, and then he's brought down to the 15. That is to Mateo Bradshaw. So they're kind of doing running back by committee with Matheson and Bradshaw here in this first quarter.
Yeah, and they're running that bread and butter play that we saw them run during warm-ups, where they're running that little inside trap or inside counter, and right now Hurricane's not stopping them, so I would imagine they'll keep trying it.
Well, until they stop you, yeah. They're going to keep doing it. And as you mentioned up front, they're not real stout.
They're
up
not
front.
Real stout, and Hurricane's big, but they're just lining up in that straight 50 defense and trying to stop them, and they're
There's Schraft on the keeper. They fake the handoff. This time they do bottle it up. So that's a great play that time by the middle linebacker, 33 for Hurricane. That is Brian Ireland on the stop. I remember Ireland, he got some significant playing time last year as a sophomore for the Tigers.
Yeah, big third down now. If you can get a stop and hopefully make them try for a field goal, you can save 4 points on this first drive. So
yeah, absolutely.
This third down's key.
They're on the 11-yard line as they break the huddle. They've got Matheson to the left, Schraft in the gun, twins to the left. He's barking out the signals. Here's the snap, the handoff to Matheson. He's got a big hole, cuts it left, and into the end zone for a touchdown for the Pirates. So just like that, Paul, Moapa Valley is on the scoreboard with a rushing touchdown.
Yeah, we talked about winning the line of scrimmage, and the Pirates won the line of scrimmage on almost every play of that drive, and that's why they took the opening possession and put a touchdown on the board, just because they're winning up front.
Well, and I'm watching the replay here, and there was just a hat on a hat, and he cuts it upfield, and there's no one in the middle of the field, and he's into the end zone for an easy six. So we're at the point after attempt by Cash Keller, number 10, and the kick is off the crossbar and in. Excuse me. So Keller was able to get just enough on it to hit the bar and popped over. So with 7:26 left in the first quarter, we'll take a quick break with the guests from Moapa Valley leading 7-0.
From bold statements to subtle compliments, Wilkinson's House of Lighting will help you more fully enjoy all the different spaces in your home. Stop in and see what's new at Wilkinson's House of Lighting, a proud sponsor of Region 10 Athletics.
When it comes to your child's teeth, Dr. Cody and his experienced staff at Johnson Pediatric Dentistry are game changers. So when it comes to checkups, a toothache, or any problem with your kid's teeth, call experienced veteran Dr. Cody Johnson at Johnson Pediatric Dentistry, 628-0511.
All right, we're back here at Tiger Stadium here in Hurricane with a score of 7-0 for the visiting Pirates. We are about to get the kickoff from Cash Keller. And back deep is number 22 for Hurricane. That's Austin McRoberts. And the kick is underway, and McRoberts lets it bounce, and it's picked up by number 7 for Hurricane, who makes a tackler miss, and then he's hit hard at the 19-yard line. That was number 7, Hunter Prince.
Number 80 down there, Davis Contop, came in and made a hit. Playing special teams and trying to earn himself some more time on the field.
He's going to ask Coach for a little more time on the defensive side. That was a nice tackle.
It was. It's important for Hurricane on this drive to try and respond and answer because they, you want to respond to that drive that Moapa Valley put together and make your own touchdown, hopefully, at the
absolutely,
end.
Absolutely, absolutely. We got the young Dylan Gabriel at quarterback. He hands off to number 20. He goes to the left side, or the right side, excuse me, and he picks up about 3-4 yards. So a nice positive start there. That was Ethan Staples on the carry.
Yeah, it was a nice run. Pulled the guard out in front, led him around the corner. That number 70 that we, 2A that we talked about, he did a good job on that to get out in front.
That's the old Green Bay pull the tackle, or yeah, pull the guard play, isn't it?
Yep.
A little old school football there for him, Hurricane. Like that. That's our kind of football right there. So Gabriel breaks the huddle. He goes two receivers to the left and one to the right. With Staples next to him, and he fakes the end around. No, he does give the end around to the – oh, and a great tackle. That was a Pledger, Kellen Pledger on the end around, and a great form tackle by Moapa Valley. That was number 4 for Moapa Valley. That was Tyson Redd, who came up and delivered a strike.
Yeah, that play looked like it was going to – make some yards, but the before he could turn up, that the guy came supporting the run and made a nice tackle.
So they were very fortunate to give him a no gain on that one. So that'll bring up 3rd and 6 now with 6:26 here in the first quarter. We've got one to the left and trips to the right as they fake the handoff, and then he rolls left, the quarterback, and he's off the field. He's breaking the 40 down to the 43-yard line. That's Dylan Gabriel on the quarterback carry for Hurricane's first down of the game.
Nice. It looked like that's a designed run where they got everything flowing, got the whole defense over-pursuing. The quarterback went to the backside and showed pretty good speed and got upfield and found the first down.
Yeah, for a young sophomore.
Plus a bunch of extra. Looks like he got 10 or 15 extra yards on that. So.
Yeah, that was an excellent run. And it looks like, the ball is back. I wonder if there is
I didn't see a penalty flag, but we may have one. Oh, they called a hold.
Wow, those are play killers right there. And the hold was, Paul, the hold was already 9 yards past
right
the first down marker, so it's going to bring it back to 3rd and about 8 now. What an unfortunate break for the Tigers, but you're right, the last play design with the trips to the wide side, Moapa Valley really all overloaded to that side of the field, thinking that's where it was going, and then they caught him by scheme. It was just a great play call.
Yeah, got a little handful of jersey that sets him back.
So Gabriel breaks the huddle now, and There's some discussion with the between the umpire, and they want the clock. There we go. So we're getting things rolling now. So we got Gabriel in the shotgun. He's got Staples to his right. He sends number two in motion to the wide side. Looks to set up a screen. It's well defended by Moapa Valley. Lofts one up to Staples, and it's incomplete. Boy, that one was almost picked off.
Yeah, when the screen's not doing what it's supposed to do, your best choice is to throw the ball in the dirt. Now they've called, because he threw the ball downfield, they called an eligible man downfield.
Oh.
Because the lineman had gotten downfield expecting the ball to be thrown behind the line of scrimmage.
Yeah, that's one of the pros and one of the cons when you unfortunately run a screenplay, isn't it?
Yeah, so if it doesn't work. That's why I said if it blows up, just throw the ball at the feet of the original receiver and live to fight another day.
Well, that'll bring up fourth and about seven or eight here for Hurricane. They will punt. It looks like number 11, Lincoln Langston, is back to do the punting. Moapa Valley Pirates, they send back number 12. That's Mateo Bradshaw and number 24, Christopher Piro, to field the punt. Langston, that snap goes over his head, and that's in the back of the end zone. Langston fakes one defender out of the way, runs out of the end zone to save his safety, and is tackled at the 7-yard line. So a huge turnover for the Hurricane Tigers, as now Moapa Valley will have an opportunity to take the ball in from their own 7-yard line.
Yeah, those are the kind of mistakes that we talked about early that you can't make and expect to win, and that's the long snapper just kind of air melted over his head, and that was a pretty athletic move by the punter to get the ball and at least get it out of the end zone, not give up the safety.
Yeah, very fortunate not to give up the safety, and did a great job just getting upfield as much as he could. So here is Schraft, who breaks the huddle. It's a quarterback keeper up the middle. He's down to the one, and he's into the end zone for
Matheson on a direct snap again.
Is that the Wildcat?
That quarterback power, yeah. Where he just took it and used the quarterback as an extra blocker and got the touchdown. So,
boy, he walked into the end zone, but they're saying he was down at the one, so I thought he was in.
Yeah, maybe he went to a knee and then bounced up.
Well, we're looking at the Holbrook asphalt replay, and he never went down.
I didn't see him go down, but
but that far referee said he was done.
One of the officials saw a phantom kneel down and put the ball on the 1-yard line.
So here come the Pirates. Schraft under center, directly under center, just keeps it and plows ahead, and no signal yet. Yeah, there it is, a touchdown for the Pirates.
The whole pile's in the end zone, so there's going to be a touchdown in there.
So just like that, the Moapa Valley Pirates are leading 13-0 with the point after to come. And the fans over on the east side of the stadium from Moapa Valley are cheering and are very happy that they made the drive up here tonight.
Yeah, we got these, what you said, we got these young kids, and it's time to kind of get a gut check and get back in this thing. You're going to get the ball back. Good news is you get the ball right back on offense and hopefully don't make those mistakes like the holding penalty that killed
that. And here's the extra point that was attempted by Keller, and this time the low kick is blocked. So great job by Hurricane being able to deny that extra point. So with that said, we got 5:04 left. The Pirates leaving 13-0 over the Hurricane Tigers here in the first quarter. We'll be back right after 1 minute.
That's not a great start.
I'm Aaron Crane, host of the Region 9 Recap. Want to relive the highlights of the game? Look for the Region 9 Recap every week. Just follow St. George News on Facebook or go to stgeorgenews.com.
Steak is so freshly grilled, you can still hear it sizzling.
I can hear it too.
Me too.
Actually, it's the...
Hello? Cheesesteak?
Grill.
Grilled right in front of you. It's a Jersey Mike's thing.
All right, we're back here at the Tiger Stadium here in Hurricane, Utah, with with Cash Keller about to take the kickoff here to the Hurricane Tigers, and the kick is off. And it's going to be fielded at the 15-yard line, coming to the wide side of the field. And he avoids one tackler and gets upfield for a nice return up to the 26-yard line. That was number 22 for Hurricane, Ashton McRoberts. Yeah, Paul, during the break, we were talking about Weber State last year and their long snapper against Montana, or Montana State, that was.
Yeah, it was a nightmare. That difference in competing for the conference championship and not, and so that was that snap. Every part of those special teams plays are important. So
that's why it's so important. You're absolutely right. Gabriel breaks the huddle and hands off to Staples, coming to the short side of the field, gets upfield, breaks one tackle, takes another one on, and picks up about 11 yards. So a nice run there on the right side, driven out of bounds by Shannon Matheson.
That was that same power play where they got big number 70 out in front, leading that, and a lot of the guys from Moapa looked like they were afraid to try and run through him, so they just let the running back keep getting up the sideline.
Well, if you're Hurricane, you might want to just stick with that play until they stop it.
Absolutely.
So here comes Gabriel. We got trips to the right and one to the left. He puts keeps it on the quarterback carry, fakes the end around, cuts up field, and picks up 5 yards. So, again, a nice positive play for the Tigers. So back-to-back running plays, netting positive yardage. So good start to this drive.
That looks good.
Well, if you're Hurricane, you really got to respond here because you can't get much further behind than two touchdowns without thinking you can come back. You just, momentum-wise, it just kills you.
Yeah, it looks like they've got a good offensive scheme. They just have to execute some plays and not have that killer penalty like on the last drive.
So Gabriel takes the snap, passes off to Staples. He goes to the left side of the line. This time there's nothing there. Might have got a half yard, if that, but big number 70. That's Hunter Neal. He's 6'2", I would guess probably about 265.
Yeah,
big guy in the middle playing the nose there, made the stop.
Yeah, the running back did a good job to keep his legs moving and get the ball back to the line of scrimmage, but they had it plugged up really well up front.
And that'll bring up third down and 5 here as Gabriel breaks the huddle, rolls to his right, looking downfield, fires downfield, it's got a guy open, and just overthrows him. Unfortunately, just overthrew number 80, Ramsey Olds. He was open, though, Paul, and could have had a big play.
That's a tough throw to make to drop that into him, but he did have at least two steps on the guy if the quarterback could have made a little bit better throw. Now looks like they're sending the punter back out, so hopefully we can get a good snap and a good punt and flip the field.
Yeah, I'm wondering if they almost ought to do a fake punt just because you're about half, at the midfield mark.
Or hard count, see if you can get five cheap yards out of it. Then you can go for it on 4th and 1.
This time the snap is good and back, and kick is away, and it is taken at the 25-yard line. And good coverage by the Tigers as they make the tackle right at the 29-yard line. So good. Good exchange that time from the center to the kicker, Langston, who got it away. And so the Pirates, who haven't been stopped on two drives so far in the first quarter, will take another shot at it at the 30-yard line. We'll give it the 30-yard line, 1st and 10.
Yeah, at least they're facing a 70-yard field, not a 7-yard field on this drive. So hopefully the defense can respond and play a little better than they did earlier.
Well, and if you're Hurricane, you need to force a fumble or something.
Yeah,
a
turnover would be big, and they really need to have those three big guys up front. They need to occupy some blocks and let those two linebackers that we talked about in the pregame, let those guys scrape and plug the holes. If those defensive linemen are letting themselves get removed, that makes it pretty tough for those linebackers to do their job.
Well, everything just gets kind of bottled up there. It looks like Moapa Valley is going to take a timeout. They didn't like what they had going there. So we'll take a quick timeout. We'll be back after a few words from our sponsors. We'll be back right after this.
Hey, it's Sheldon Demke. Check out the latest episode of What's on the Menu, a behind-the-scenes tour of local restaurants. We'll see some of their favorite dishes and get an inside look on how these dishes are prepared. Check out this week's episode at stgeorgenews.com and click the shows on the menu tab.
Asphalt. It's not something we think about much, except when it's in bad shape. At Holbrook Asphalt, we help cities, HOAs, and businesses avoid replacing painfully expensive roads and parking lots. To avoid the cost of replacing asphalt, you must effectively preserve it while it's still in good condition. University research has shown Holbrook Asphalt's HA5 slows asphalt aging by 67%. We make your pavement assets last longer, cost less to own, all while achieving higher property values. Visit HolbrookAsphalt.com to discover more.
All right, we're back live, and here's the quarterback keeper up the left side who gets upfield and takes on the safety for about 14 yards there. That was a great fake that time by Schraft, and he just kept the ball on the quarterback keeper and picked up 15 yards. So a big gainer right out of the timeout.
Yeah, that was a little bit different than what they've been doing. They faked that inside trap, and then the quarterback just took the ball straight up the field, so... They're mixing things up on offense, and so far the defense from Hurricane hasn't responded.
Yeah, they go this time they got twins to the left, to the wide side.
Here's That's a false start. Yeah, there we go. Number 55 was a little anxious.
We got an old lineman here next to me. He's picking these things up. Speaking of which, let's give a shout-out to the family back in Salt Lake. We just got a text. They're streaming the game back home and checking in on you, Paul, making sure you're doing all right tonight.
The Nielsen's up there in Canyon Rim out enjoying the evening and watching some high school football.
Well, we appreciate their support, so thanks for having them chime on in with us.
Yeah, I said when I started that we got tens of additional viewers this week because of me being here, so I'm glad to have my family supporting me, and this is a lot of fun.
Well, thanks for supporting us. We appreciate it. And there's the snap over Schraft's head. Back to the 22-yard line, is picked up, and then he's hit and driven backwards. Matheson was, so there's a big play that Hurricane needed. Schraft was directing traffic, trying to change the play, and the ball went right over his head. And just like that, it'll bring up a second down and about 40 to go.
Yeah, second and an Uber. call your rideshare driver, see if you can get the yardage for a first down. That's a long field, but they have three plays, so.
Oh, that's true. Second and about 31 yards, it looks like. I over-exaggerated. Yeah. It wasn't 40, but moves it all the way back to the 21-yard line. So that's a big play for Hurricane if they can capitalize here and get a three and out.
Yep.
Schraft breaks the huddle. We got trips to the left. Fakes the handoff. Oh, it does give it to number 29. That is Brody Redd, who gets upfield and picks up about 7-8 yards. That'll bring up a third down and about 29.
Yeah, third and very long. So hopefully we can get the three and out that you were talking about.
One thing we're not seeing from the Hurricane side, Paul, is we're not getting, doesn't look like much penetration up front.
Yeah, I was just going to say, no pressure on the quarterback when he throws, and no, we're not really, they're not removing, Hurricane's not removing the line of scrimmage. So
that'll bring up third and extremely long here for the Pirates. Schraft barking out the play in shotgun. They do a double reverse, an inside handoff to number 4. He'll pick up about 10 yards. That was Tyson Redd. So that'll bring up a third down and about 15, 16 yards. Well, it looks like the Pirates, they are going to punt. So good job by Hurricane being able to hold the Pirates back and get a three and out here. And with 45 seconds left in the first quarter, they'll get the ball back right before the quarter ends. Here's the snap back, and the kick is away by Matheson.
Boy, that's a nice high school punt right there.
All the way down to the 18-yard line, and it's fair caught by Hurricane. That is number 700 Prince. So with 36 seconds left in the first quarter, Paul, we'll give the Tigers another chance. Yeah, get on the scoreboard.
They got the good play, the little break that they were looking for on that bad snap that put Moapa way behind the chains, and now that got them the ball back with a chance on offense and another possession here before the end, right at the end of the first quarter.
Well, I think Hurricanes found some things that have been successful with the run game. If I think if they can keep working that.
Yeah, the first down's a key to not get in second and third and long because their passing game hasn't been very successful. They have had some really nice run plays.
There's Gabriel in the shotgun, and there's a delayed handoff to Staples. Staples runs right into big number 70 that time. That is Hunter Neal.
Yeah, he's occupying the middle of the line of scrimmage for sure.
He's just kind of taking up space in there, isn't he?
He's hard to move.
So Hurricane breaks the huddle. They go trips to the right. Gabriel takes the snap, rolls to his right, looking, surveying, looking. And now he's lofting out to number 80. He's got him down to the 45-yard line. That is Ramsey Olds with the reception. So a nice patience that time by Gabriel. Waited for him to get open.
Yeah, Olds did a really good job when he saw his quarterback scrambling to kind of run out into that open spot. And the quarterback did a good job to throw him open. So that was nice on both of their parts to
recognize that.
And a really good job by the offensive line because he didn't have pressure.
Yeah.
He could survey the field and wait for that to develop.
So that'll bring up first down from the 48. Here's the handoff to Staples in the backfield. Slips one tackle, then gets brought down after about a gain of 3 yards. So, again, nice job by Staples just avoiding that first initial tackler. And that'll bring up the end of the first quarter. So with the Moapa Valley Pirates 13, the Hurricane Tigers 0, we'll take a 1 minute timeout and come back for the second quarter.
Is the place with a helpful heart.
See Hurst First this month for great deals on red hot buys at Hurst Ace Hardware. Make sure and get an Ace Rewards card for savings around the house, the yard, or the job site. Stop by Hurst General Store Ace Hardware, conveniently located in the heart of downtown Cedar City and St. George.
From your first major crossroads and surprising new chapters to fulfilling lifelong dreams, we're here. Through all of your firsts, U First Credit Union is here for you. Come grow with us.
We love giving back to our community, and over the years, we have provided vehicles for families in need, supported local charities, and helped train our first responders. Dealer Collision, your place for collision repair.
Red Rock Real Estate has over 200 professional realtors in the St. George area that specialize in the local market. Whether you're buying your dream home, looking for an investment property, or want to sell your home for the highest amount, the Red Rock Real Estate team is here to assist you. Get started now by visiting redrockrealestate.com.
All right, we're back here at Tiger Stadium. Gabriel takes the snap and fakes it to Steeples on the handoff, goes up the middle, and he picks up 6 tough yards, and that'll bring up a third down now and about a yard and a half, 2 yards for the first down. This might be 4 down territory right here, Paul.
Yeah, I was just thinking that same thing, that they need to get either a conversion on third or fourth down because they don't want to give the ball back to them down 2 scores.
So Gabriel breaks the huddle. He's got trips to the right, one to the left. Hands off, fakes it to Staples. Goes around the left side, the wide side. Gets a block, gets upfield, and is upended there at the 36-yard line. So a great keep that time by Gabriel. He read the play perfectly there and picked up the first down. Tackle made by Tyson Red for the Pirates.
And a really good job by number 10, who was shielding his guy. And then when he realized that if he continued the block, he was either going to get called with a block in the back or a hold. And he just backed off. And
nice. That's C.J. Trump, a young sophomore.
Yep.
So great.
Smart play.
Great awareness.
Smart
yeah.
football play.
Gabriel breaks the huddle. We got trips to the left. He hands off to Staples to the left side, the short side of the field. And he stood up that time by number 4 from Moapa Valley. Kind of stands over him. And they got a little chippiness going on down there. That's Tyson Red. We've mentioned his name a few times so far in this first half.
Yeah, Tune is defending his guy. I'm not a huge fan of running wide plays into the short side of the field.
Yeah.
That's you just run out of room.
You sometimes wonder. You're like, you're stringing it out, but you don't have much room to go. But maybe they're setting it up for a big play here, on the second play. Yeah. So Gabriel, he breaks the huddle. He's got Staples to his right, and he's got Twins to the right. The Calls for the snap, fakes the Staples. He's going upfield to number 10, and he got him on the quick slant, and he'll pick up the first down. Helmet off.
Came off. He got the penalty flag. I don't know if he grabbed a face mask that made the helmet come off.
That's the case. We might get another 15 yards on top of this, but that's a nice throw right there. They fake the end around, hit the quick hitter, and just like that, the Tigers are moving.
Yeah. If it is a face mask, 10 gets to stay in the game, too, so.
Oh, that's right, because the helmet came off, yeah. And we keep saying 10. That's C.J. Trump again. We mentioned his name earlier on this drive. That's a couple of big plays by the young sophomore. So, yeah, they're going to give him 15 yards on the penalty.
I don't know if that will keep him in the game or not.
That penalty moves the ball down to the 10-yard line. So that takes us into...
Oh, personal foul face mask. I was correct.
Yeah, you were right. That takes us into the red zone, the Cache Valley Bank red zone. Tigers' first time in the red zone tonight. Gabriel calls for the ball, hands off to Staples, going left into the short side of the field, slips one tackle, but has stood up right. Maybe lost a half a yard or a yard there. Again, running into the short side of the field there, Paul.
Yeah, and the defense slanted to that short side, and so it looked like a team photo of the Moapa defense when the poor running back got the ball.
It's like
he did a good job to get back close to the line of scrimmage, but that was well played by the defense.
It is a loss of 1 yard, so that'll be second down and 11 to go. And that will bring up Gabriel in the shotgun. He's got Steeples next to him to his right. He fakes the handoff to Steeples. Down the line, fakes the option. He's still fighting for yardage. Gets down to about the 10-yard line, so he'll get 1 yard back. It looked like he might have had the running back that was running the option with. He could have hit him on the pitch.
The pitch looked good.
He faked the pitch to Kellen Pledger. And I think if he had got it to him, Pledger might have got the corner, maybe got a few more yards.
Yeah, had the angle to the cone for sure.
So Gabriel, he breaks the huddle now. He's hobbling a little bit looking to that left knee, but he looks like he'll be okay. We got trips to the left. Steeples to his left. He rolls left. He's looking, throws into the end zone. He's got number 80 and a go! And a great defensive play by number 4. That was Tyson Redd. Knocked it out of Old's hands there at the last minute, or else they would have had a score on the scoreboard.
Yeah, got the ball in his hands. The defender did a good job to get his hands between and up in there and pull the ball out.
I was impressed that time with Gabriel. He squared his shoulders up, made a nice solid throw. I thought mechanics looked good that way.
Yeah, and the line did a good job to keep pressure off him and give him a chance to throw. And he made a good throw. The defender just made a great play, so...
That'll bring in Lincoln Langston, the kicker for Hurricane, for the field goal. Here's the snap back. It's up, and it looks good. And it is good. So Hurricane is on the board. 13-3 now with 8:37 left in the second quarter. So we'll take a quick timeout, and we'll be back right after this break.
As a local business owner, it's important to get the word out about your business. More people equals more revenue for you. Get your business in front of over 160,000 people in Southern Utah each week with St. George News. Contact St. George News today.
We know it takes an entire community to make Southern Utah thrive. You will see us on the fields, on the courts, at festivals, and in the schools, and everywhere in between. From Southern Utah's Auto Mall, we help you create memories that bolster joy in our community. It's the reason why we've got it made in Southern Utah and why you've got it made at Stephen Wade.
All right, we're back live now here at Hurricane Stadium in Hurricane, Utah. And Langston approaches the ball and kicks it, and it rolls out of bounds. So that'll be a penalty on the kickoff, and Moapa Valley will get the ball on the 35-yard line.
And that's the second time they've done that, so that's 20 yards that they've given up in penalties.
On the kickoffs, right?
Yeah, just kick the ball straight down the middle and let your guys run and make tackles.
You almost want to say just, boot it as far as you can and let us run down and make a play. But they may be a little concerned about it. Maybe Moapa Valley's got a good return guy, and that's why they're staying away from him. But and it, with that said, it'll bring up first and 10 from the 35 for the Pirates. The Tigers was able to get a three and out last possession and got 3 points out of it. So here is the snap. Little swing pass out there in the flat to the running back. That's Matheson. Breaks a tackle. Gets upfield. Cuts back to the right. He's still on his feet. Down to the 30, 29-yard line. That is Shannon Matheson with some good hard running, Paul.
Yeah, and great balance when they tripped him up there in the middle. He recovered and got his balance back up. Picked up another 15 yards on that run. That pass was backwards, so that'll just count as a running play and a long handoff.
Boy, if you're the quarterback, you want those stats, but unfortunately, Matheson gets it as a running stat. But he deserved it. He ran hard. He cut left, broke a few tackles, come back into the middle of the field. He runs hard.
Their offense has run through him so far in this first half, and he does run hard.
Schraft breaks the huddle, calls for the ball. The hands off to number 12. That is Mateo Bradshaw. Good time good job this time up front by Hurricane. Was able to bring that tackler down.
Better stop, gets short yardage on first down, sets him up better for a second down play. They were lucky that Matheson was off the field, I guess. So they have been platooning, giving him a little bit of a rest by bringing in the Bradshaw. But he's not on the field again on this second down.
Schraft breaks the huddle. He's got one to his right, one to his left. He's got calls for the ball, fakes the handoff, goes with a hot pass to the tight end, number 8, Branson Romero, and in and out of his hand. So that'll be third and bring up a third down and 8.
Third and long. It's big down for the Hurricane defense right here.
Well, I'm sure, Paul, they would probably go for it, you know, considering where they're at on the field. But I don't know what kind of kicking game they got, but. Having seen their two extra points. I think they're going to go for it.
Look like Megan Rapinoe trying to take that penalty kick for the U.S. women's team.
You're probably going to get a naughty email from her over the weekend.
That's all right. The only difference is he wants the ball to go over the bar.
There's Schraft with the handoff and a nice tackle. Woo! And number 33 for the Hurricane Tigers. That was Braylon Ireland with the stop. We called his name earlier today. Bringing up now a fourth and about 5. That was a nice tackle.
Yeah, and I think Moapa is going to go for it. Like you said, their field goal kicker, their place kicker, hasn't been impressive on their extra points, and you don't want to punt. You just, the net punt would be 4 yards if it went in the end zone. So this makes good sense.
With 7 minutes left here in the second quarter, brings up a key point in the game here, fourth and about 5. And it looks like the Pirates are going to talk. Oh, Hurricane's going to talk it over. Boy, this could really be a momentum swinger for Hurricane. I mean, they went down, they scored last time, got 3 points. If they could get a fourth down stop here, turn around and push the ball in, we might have ourselves a ball game.
Yeah, if Hurricane can score, what I like to call the middle 8, the last 4 of the first half, first 4 of the second half, if they could score. If they can hold them here and score before halftime, get the ball after halftime.
Because they will get the ball. That's right.
Yeah, they get the ball coming out. So it's this is a key fourth down. They came out in that trips, and when they got out, they had Matheson in the slot in those trips, and that the matchups were something that the Hurricane coaches did not like. Called a timeout to talk about it and hopefully get a better alignment for what it is that Moapa Valley is going to bring to them on this fourth down.
Wouldn't be surprised if they went with that same formation and did some inside trap with Matheson or something that way. We've seen that tonight. But then again, here we are. We got trips to the wide side, the right side of the field.
And we got them spread out.
Schraft takes the snap. It's a middle screen, and it's picked off by Hurricane number 55. And he slid and fumbled, but they pick up the ball on the 44-yard line.
That was exactly what we were saying they needed was a turnover like that.
Boy, what a play. That number 55 for Hurricane. He read that play all the way. Let me get a name there. That was Trey Hershey, what a great play by Hershey. Reading that play all the way, that middle screen.
Yeah, he sat on that screen, and the quarterback didn't see him there, kind of lurking behind the running back, and pretty good hands for a linebacker, D-lineman guy. So.
Yeah, he looked like he could go on the offensive side. Well, that might be our defensive play of the game right there, our Mountain Land Supply defensive play. We'll have to mark that one down and remember that one, Paul.
Yeah, for sure.
Well, Gabriel breaks the huddle. He's got trips to his right, one to the left. He takes the direct snap, goes upfield, cuts up, and picks up about a yard, yard and a half. So not much treading going in that middle area where big number 70 is for Moapa Valley.
Yeah, they've been doing much better when they go to the outside because the middle's plugged up pretty well by the nose tackle.
You're an old school guy, and I don't mean this rudely, but number 70 reminds me of a William Perry, the fridge.
Yeah, he's
just couldn't move him. Here's Gabriel with the snap. He goes to the left flat in the wide side of the field, but a great tackle, and the ball pops up, and it's picked up by number 5 for Moapa Valley. That's Mark Villa on the turnover. What a series.
Yeah, that's just had a turnover and had momentum a little bit in your favor, and that's the kind of play that can crush those dreams and hopes that you were starting to get.
That was number 4 for the Pirates, Moapa Valley. That was Tyson Red. We've mentioned his name quite a few times. He's had a pass breakup. He's had a big hit here that caused a fumble.
Yeah, he put his helmet right across the runner where he's supposed to, got his head right on the ball, and it popped free, and number 5 was just in a fortunate position, caught the ball out of the air, and luckily Hurricane was able to tackle him before he could get the sideline on that. And it looks like the
receiver's still down.
Someone's
yeah.
still down here.
I think it was the Hurricane receiver that caught the ball. I'm trying to get a number there. But, man, he took a solid hit by Tyson Redd, that's for sure. And he's up and going. That's number 2.
Kellen Pledger.
Pledger, that's right. He's one of their key guys, so they can't afford to lose him. Good news is he's walking off on his own power, so that's good. Probably got a little wind knocked out of him. If you've ever had that happen to you, you know it's not a fun feeling.
Yeah, they're kind of looking at his ribs, so he probably that was a good, a very hard hit that he took to his rib cage. And
clean, too. It was a clean shot. It wasn't a dirty one. So, yeah, absolutely.
It's just good football.
So, Talon Schraft breaks the huddle for the Pirates. He hands off to number 12, the running back, going left. And he'll get about 1 yard, maybe a yard and a half. That's Mateo Bradshaw. So, good job that time by the Hurricane defense stringing that one out.
Yeah, they've done a pretty good job of stopping 12, Bradshaw, when he runs the ball. It's the Shannon Matheson that's giving him trouble running up the middle, and the quarterback, too, when he runs. So he's the trouble for him. But now, again, that's a good play on first down, makes second and long.
Yeah, if Hurricane can keep him second, third and long, they'll be okay. Schraft breaks the huddle. He's got one to his right, one to his left, and Shannon Matheson's in the back. Gets the handoff, going wide, and he'll break a couple of tackles. He's still going, and he's all the way down to about the 28-9 yard line. So he'll pick up a first down and a good positive 10 yards right there.
Yeah, a couple of arm tackles attempted, and that's not a running back that you bring down with an arm tackle. You've got to get your pads low, get him on him, and bring him down. He's a good, really good running back. Runs hard.
He runs really hard. I've been really impressed with how he likes to deliver a shot when he goes to get tackled, too. Little throwback to the Walter Payton days.
Yeah.
So Schraft breaks the huddle, sends 2 to the right. Barking out the signals now. Gets the ball, hands off to the running back. Oh, no. It was a little bit
of a reverse
there. Yeah, a double reverse inside there. And I thought he handed off to the running back, but he did, and he turned it around and gave it to the tight end. That's 29, Brody Redd, and he got about half a yard.
Yeah, another good job on first down on the defense to put him in second and long. and hopefully they can get another stop.
So that brings up second down and about, well, he didn't even get a yard, so we'll say 10 with 4:35 here left in the second quarter. Moapa Valley leading 13-3. They're on the Hurricane 30-yard line. Schraft barking out the play. Got trips to the right. Sends the man in motion on the wide sweep, number 29. And he gets upfield, gets about 9, 10 yards, but a flag has been thrown. My flag. Guess is we got a hold.
Yeah, it looks like it's in the area where it would be holding on that end man on the line of scrimmage. Number 55's got his hands up like he had his hand in the cookie jar, so maybe him that was that the call's on.
55 for the Pirates is Gary Levitt. He's a senior offensive lineman, and, yep, it looks like they're moving backwards, so that's a big play.
Just remember, O linemen never hold. If they throw a flag, it's because they saw something. We never hold.
Never. Having been a defensive end, you guys always said that.
Yeah, that's the eternal battle is what's holding going on. There's a lot of stuff going on in those trenches up there that you have to have been there to know what it is. But
yep.
Holding is one of them that you say, I wasn't holding him.
I don't know what you're talking about. So Schrapp breaks the huddle, hands off this time to number 12. That would be to Bradshaw, and he gets about 3 yards up to the 35 and a half yard line. So that'll bring up third and long.
That was a better run, but they have them well behind the chains and in third and long, so hopefully they can get a stop. And I don't know, this is in that kind of no man's land where if they threw an incomplete pass right now, I don't know if they would punt or go for it on fourth down because it's in between.
My guess is they probably go for it just to take more time off the clock and get this closer to halftime.
Yeah, that's – and not give Hurricane a shorter field if they did miss. But
trips to the right. Schraft calls for the ball. He rolls to his right. He's looking. He's getting some pressure. He goes deep for down the right sideline, and it's overthrown. And so that's great defense by the Tigers. That'll bring up a fourth and about 15. Stopping the clock with 3:25 left. Schraft was trying to get that ball into Tyson Redd, but that was good coverage by the defense. It's kind of a...
Yeah, I was trying to see if the quarterback had gone off the field or if he was going to stay on. Looks like they're coming on to try something on 4th and 15. So they decided against the punt and... Schraff throw the ball over him.
I think that was our guy, number 55, who got the pick earlier.
Yeah.
So they break the huddle here with two to the left, one to the right. Schraff calling for the ball in the shotgun, drops back, looking left, going deep down the right, left sideline, and it's well overthrown. Boy, he had a wide open receiver.
Yeah, on the right side. If his eyes had come back to the right, that would have been different. But it looks like...
Yeah, that'll be a turnover of downs. But number 80, that is Davis Contop, who was wide open down the middle of the field. He's going back to the sidelines, just begging for him to throw the ball to him.
So with the illegal shift was called on Moapa, but, of course, Hurricane declined that penalty, and they'll take the ball. So
Hurricane will take the ball on the 35-yard, their 35-yard line with 3:18 left here in the second half. So big turnover of downs there.
Same thing holds that we talked about earlier about those middle 8 minutes. Any score right here would really help.
Gabriel rolls left, squares it. There he is. Number 10 open. Oh, just underthrown a little bit. And another great play by Tyson Redd, the cornerback for the Pirates, able to break that up at the last minute. Boy, if he could have let him just a little bit.
Yeah, that C.J. Trump's been open a few times, and that was one of those where you throw him open, throw the ball a little more towards the middle of the field where he can run to it and away from his defender, but hung up just a bit, and the defender was able to recover.
And Gabriel, I know he doesn't want to throw it more to the middle because you got that safety.
Yeah,
you
got
lumen,
that free safety over the top.
Man, if he could have squoze that in just a little more, he might have scored.
Yeah, he had a step.
So Gabriel breaks the huddle here. We've got the Hurricane students getting into it a little bit here. There's the snap. Fake to Staples. He goes out to Trump, who dodges one player, gets upfield for about 5 yards. So a positive pass play there.
Yeah, made a couple of guys miss at the line of scrimmage and made a nice positive 4 or 5 yard play out of that.
Boy, for being a young sophomore, I like the way Trump looks. He's getting he's shifty. And he's
one of those guys that maybe learned a lot last week because he's playing a really nice game tonight.
Third and five now with 2:40 left here in the second quarter. Gabriel breaks the huddle, sends trips to the right, gets the snap, a little low. Right. Rolling, goes downfield, and he's got number 80 open, and he makes the catch. Great adjustment by Ramsey Olds on the rollout.
Yeah, tough to turn back around and make that catch, keep your feet in bounds. Did everything right, so 2.5 minutes left, and on the plus side of the 50-yard line, looking at getting some more points before the half.
Yeah, that's a 20-yard pickup on the pass play. Gabriel breaks out, fumbles the snap, rolls left a little bit, resets, fires downfield. He's got a guy open. That's Trump down to the 8-yard line.
There it is. So that throw was a little bit late again, but Trump kind of blocked out like a basketball rebounder and kept the defender off him and made that catch.
Yeah, the basketball coach is going to try to get him to try out here. He did a great job boxing him out, getting his body in between the defender and the ball. And we've got the Tigers down into the Cache Valley Bank red zone, down to the 8-yard line. Gabriel calling for the snap, got trips to the right, takes the snap, fakes right to throw. Now under
pressure. That's a horse collar.
Big number 70 is going to get a sack, but he's also going to get a
taunting. 15-yard penalty, yep. And he should have got called for horse collar because he grabbed the quarterback by his horse collar and pulled him back to him and then sacked him. So,
and the coach, Coach Lewis for the Pirates, comes running onto the field to get his attention, just giving him an earful, saying, why are you giving him a free first down after making a play like that?
Yeah, sometimes it's been a long time since I was a junior in high school, but I remember there's a lot of emotion going on. So sometimes you forget.
Well, and coach has got to realize that big guy, he's working inside. He's got a lot of emotions going, and he's happy to get a sack, but he's not in the NFL. They don't let you do that here, not in high school. So that'll bring up a second down. So it doesn't give him an automatic first down, but it does move the ball back to about the 8-yard line.
Yeah, got him half the distance to the goal. So they got positive yards on the play, even though there was a sack.
Here's the snap and the handoff to Staples going to the short side of the field. Cuts off field. And he gets down to the goal line and in for the touchdown.
Is he holding on? Did he hold on to the ball?
I haven't seen a signal. I thought he was. They're calling him down at the one yard. Oh, man. I saw Staples in the end zone, so I thought.
Yeah, he went in the end zone, but I think when he got hit, he dropped the ball out of bounds.
Gotcha. Okay. Thank you, Paul. Man, I got glasses on and everything. I still can't see what's going on.
There's a lot of traffic down there, and that is the far side of the field from where we are.
Well, that'll bring up third down and goal on the 2-yard line with a minute left here in the second quarter. Here's the fake to Steeples. No, they give it to him, and he's going to get down to the 1. So bring up fourth down and 1.
Smart thing to do right here is just let your whole play clock run out and call your timeout. Don't call the timeout right now.
It looks like Moapa has called a timeout. So.
Okay. Now Hurricane called the timeout.
Oh, they did.
Yeah,
I'm with you. I probably would have let it run down.
Let the clock run so you give less time to Moapa Valley after whatever happens on this fourth down play. But they do need to go for it. I don't know. One school of thought is kick the field goal, make it a one-score game at halftime. And the other is try to make the touchdown and still a one-score game but only a three-point game. So that's a tough decision for a coach to make. But
just think of the momentum you'd get going into halftime, but it looks like they're shuffling some players in and out. So I don't know if they're going to bring the kicker in.
Yeah, I'm because of the fact that they get the ball after the break, I'd be more inclined to take 3 points and get the ball with a chance to tie the game right after the half.
Yeah, I think I'm with you on that one. If that's the case, they shouldn't have called timeout and ran the clock down like you said.
That's what I was saying. But
not your first rodeo, is it?
Like I said, I've been watching football for 50 years, so
Well, that'll bring us to this key fourth down.
Yeah, this is a huge play in this game.
We got 2 yards to go for the Hurricane Tigers to hit pay dirt. 54.8 seconds left in the half. Oh, looks like they're going to put a little more time back on the clock, so 59 seconds. The anxiety on both sides with this delay in the clock. There we go. Now it's 59 minutes.
It's going to be a long time to halftime.
Now watch them say, we got to let it just run down.
Yeah, remember those old scoreboards where you had to let it
you
run
can't
down
reprogram
from wherever
it.
You were? Yeah.
There we go. We got it right. 59 seconds left here in the first half. We'll reset things here for you. We got fourth down and two on the 2 yard line for Hurricane. Gabriel calls for the snap. They send the guy in motion, fakes it to him, goes up the middle, and he'll score. So the Tigers are on. That's Gabriel, the quarterback, Dylan Gabriel, with the 2 yard scamper. And the Tigers get their first touchdown offensively of the season.
And I was completely wrong. They should have gone for it. that was a gutsy call by the coach to put that risk, and that definitely is going to give them some momentum if they can get a stop on defense and get the ball coming out of the halftime with a chance to take the lead.
Yeah, that's a good point. So you can see both sides of that, you know, and either one would be good. It looks like we might have a penalty, though, after the play, an unsportsmanlike against Hurricane.
Yeah.
So that will be, I think that'll be assessed probably on the kickoff.
On the kickoff, which is I don't know how many timeouts Moapa has left.
I think they got two left. They only used the one.
Yeah,
so
you could give them the ball with 50
almost
sec-
a minute, yeah.
50 seconds and two timeouts near midfield. That's again, one of those things where you gotta learn to control your emotions, and it's great to celebrate the first touchdown of the year, but got to remember you just got back in this ball game, and you don't want to make a mistake like that.
Coach always told me, act like you've been there before, right?
That's right.
Here's the point after attempt by number 11. That's Lincoln Langston, and it's good. So with 55.8 seconds left in the first half, the score is 13 for Moapa Valley and 10 for the Hurricane Tigers. We'll take a quick break, and we'll be back right after these words from one of our sponsors.
Red Rock Real Estate has over 200 professional realtors in the St. George area that specialize in the local market. Whether you're buying your dream home, looking for an investment property, or want to sell your home for the highest amount, the Red Rock Real Estate team is here to assist you. Get started now by visiting redrockrealestate.com.
Welcome back to Tiger Stadium here in Hurricane. We've got the home team. Hurricane Tigers 10, the Moapa Valley Pirates 13 with 55 seconds left here in the second half. Hurricane's been able to find some stops on defense, and the offense has come to life a little here, Paul. What do you think will happen here in the next 55 seconds?
Well, Hurricane really needs to stiffen up on defense and make it get a stop, because they have the momentum right now. They were outscored early. There's
the kickoff. It's a squib kick, and it fumbled down in the middle of the field. They tried to fake a reverse.
Yeah, right now it's just down to who's got the guts under the pile. Looks like Moapa got the ball back.
That almost looked like a comedy of errors there for a moment. But
that really could have been a tragedy for Moapa Valley to give the ball up right there. But all of the penalty yards for the unsportsmanlike conduct go away with the mishandling of the ball, and they're back at the 26-yard line like it was almost like it was a touchback.
Yeah, like a touchback. You're right. And that's, if you're a Hurricane fan, that's a big break, because probably saved yourself 15, maybe 20 yards there.
Yeah, because they got no return in trying to handle the ball back there, and that negates the penalty after the touchdown.
Well, that'll bring up a first down from the 27. Schraff breaks the huddle, one to the left, one to the right. Sends number seven in motion, fakes the handoff, comes back with a counter play to Sheldon. And they bottle him up, Hurricane does, after about 4 or 5 yards. So not too bad there. Looks like the Pirates are reluctant to just kind of run the clock out. They called a timeout.
They did call their timeout. So
I thought by them running a running play, they were kind of content to call it a half. But with 39 seconds left, they call a timeout.
Yeah, and like we said, talking about their place kicker, they're not trying to get the ball in field goal range. They're going to try and throw something deep or break Matheson out on a long run, because he's hard to tackle. Even on that play right there, they had five Hurricane Tigers around him, stopped his forward progress, but they didn't get him to the ground because he is a really tough runner. They were trying to strip the ball. They were doing everything they could to him.
So if you're the Pirates from Moapa Valley, would you design a play to maybe get Matheson on the ball,
him,
I would assume?
Get him in space and get him the ball.
Maybe a little screen play or something that way.
Screen play, that play they ran.
Lateral.
That lateral play that they ran to him earlier that turned into a 40-yard running play because it was a lateral pass. So that's where I'd be going with the ball for sure.
Okay. Well, it looks like the Matheson is going to be split out to the left. They Schraft rolls to the left, throws to the underneath guy. That's number 80, and a great open field tackle.
Great tackle, keeps the clock rolling, short of the first down. And I don't know if they have another timeout, because they're not using it if they do.
Yeah, that was Davis Contop on the reception. And the clock is down under 18 seconds now. I think
they did call their timeout, but it's...
every time I think they're not...
Yeah, every time you think they're just going to call it and go have your halftime adjustments, they call their timeout. But they wasted 8 or 10 seconds there deciding to take the timeout. So.
Well, they'll bring up when they come back a third and about three, a long three, for a first down.
Yeah, it looked to me on that last play that they were doing what we had talked about, that they had Matheson running the deep out and then the tight end on that shorter out, and Hurricane responded with some over-under coverage on number one, and that's what left the tight end open. So it was good coverage by Hurricane, made the quarterback check down to that short runner, and then a great open field tackle to keep him from the first down that would have stopped the clock and forced him to use that other timeout.
Yeah, that was an excellent tackle. I forgot to grab the number on that from Hurricane, but he read that play perfectly, and the tackle was real nice. Well, here we are, third down and three. They give the handoff this time to Matheson, goes to the wide side, goes to the cuts it upfield, picks up the first down, out past the 50 to the 48-yard line. So
yeah,
that'll give 10 seconds left. That was a nice 20-yard pickup there by Matheson.
Yeah, and I don't know what kind of an arm number nine has, but they're getting closer to being in the area where they can throw the old Hail Mary pass on the last play of the half and see where the ball comes down.
I wouldn't be surprised if they try to roll him left and try to hit that guy in the seam where he was left uncovered earlier in the game.
It's with 10 seconds left, they can run one play and try and get a little closer before that.
So they go Hail Mary. Left, and they go underneath to – oh, and a big hit. My goodness, what a hit.
That was number 11.
Langston.
Langston put a nice – he was probably the one that made that tackle on the other, and that'll get us to the halftime because
they don't have any timeouts. So that was Tyson Redd. Tyson Redd has been laying the lumber on a couple people. He got one back now. So here we are at halftime at Hurricane Stadium with the score 13-10 in favor of the visiting team, Moapa Valley Pirates. We'll take a break, a couple-minute break, and be back with our halftime show here in just a bit.
We are Utah's financial outfitter, and we're here when it's time for your business to climb higher. Cash Valley Bank, mountains await. Member FDIC, equal housing lender.
Wade Auto Center is committed to supporting our community. We are here to assist you and your family through every step of your life. This dedication to Southern Utah is born from the core values of the Wade family to support education, healthcare, homelessness, patriotism, heritage, and recreation that all add to our quality of life. At Stephen Wade Auto Center, we're working with you to ensure we've got it made here in Southern Utah and that you've got it made at Stephen Wade.
Local media has the biggest impact on your daily life. It's what's around you, what matters. And at Canyon Media, our goal is to deliver the very best in local entertainment, news, and media. From our award-winning radio stations like 99.9 Coney Country to Southern Utah's number one source for local news, St. George News, Canyon Media, here for you.
From your very first investment to your passage from one stage of life into the next, we're here. Through all of your firsts, U First Credit Union is here for you. Come grow with us.
Property and want to rent it? Then you need the right team with 11 years of local experience, a staff of over 25 employees, and a 4.9 Google rating. Aim to maximize your rental income and find quality tenants while keeping turnover low to increase your revenue and truly maintain your property. Learn more at redrockpropertymanagement.com.
Nets on Fire is the premier indoor basketball training facility in Southern Utah, with four full-size gyms and group and individual training packages available for every age and skill level. Nets on Fire can elevate your game. Hoop it, Nets!
Appliance or two, AWP's got you. Check out the remodeled expansive showroom highlighting the cafe series with colors like matte black, matte white, and modern glass. Make your kitchen stand out. Come see the local boys at AWP across the freeway from the Bloomington Walmart.
From bold statements to subtle compliments, Wilkinson's House of Lighting will help you more fully enjoy all the different spaces in your home. Stop in and see what's new at Wilkinson's House of Lighting, a proud sponsor of Region 10 Athletics.
There's not a bad seat in the house. It's From the Bleachers with Mark Musgrave and Caden Formaster on Fox Sports Southern Utah. Tune in weekdays from 4 to 6 for Region 10 high school sports, Utah Tech athletics, NFL, NBA, MLB, and more. Hurst Ace Hardware is conveniently located in St. George on the corner of Bluff Street and St. George Boulevard. With 30,000 square feet of lawn and garden, paint, tools, fabrics, sporting goods, and the most complete nut and bolt section in town. Hurst General Store, the big Ace store on Bluff and on Main and Cedar City.
Your own relaxing, comfortable space. Boulevard Home offers the guaranteed best prices on furniture, appliances, mattresses, and more. And buy with no interest financing. Shop Boulevard Home, because home is who we are.
Thank you for voting Adams Wealth Advisors the gold winner for Best Financial Planner in the Best of Northern Utah competition. Understanding your family, jobs, and goals is how Adams Wealth Advisors will continue to earn your trust.
This is Craig Adams. At Adams Wealth Advisors, we are here to help you receive peace of mind whether you've done a lot of planning or a little planning. Count on our team at Adams Wealth Advisors for honesty, professionalism, and integrity.
Visit AdamsWealthAdvisors.com or call 752-1702 to schedule a time with an advisor today. Please see AdamsWealthAdvisors.com for more information on these recent awards.
Hey, it's Luke with Uding Associates at American Family Insurance. At Uding Associates, we love insurance so you don't have to. With a quick call, we can get you an instant quote with the right coverages. My team of licensed agents are ready to help you with better insurance from American Family. Give us a call at 435-251-9102.
When it comes to your child's teeth, Dr. Cody and his experienced staff at Johnson Pediatric Dentistry are game changers. So when it comes to checkups, a toothache, or any problem with your kid's teeth, call experienced veteran Dr. Cody Johnson at Johnson Pediatric Dentistry, 628-0511.
We'll be right back. Welcome back, everybody. It's the Rally Stop halftime show here at Hurricane Tiger Stadium with a score of 13-10 for Moapa Valley. We've had quite an exciting first half, Paul. This, again, is our halftime show sponsored to you by Rally Stop. Welcome to the Rally I already said that already, didn't I, Paul?
Yeah.
Rally Stop up in Cedar City. Anytime you need to stop in, refuel, get soda, whatever you need, Rally Stop is the place to go. Paul, what are your thoughts on that first half?
Well, you know, early on with the breaks and the long drive that Moapa Valley had at first and then the turnover and the touchdown, Hurricane very easily could have tucked their tails and got run out of their own stadium. But they clawed back, if you're going to continue that Tiger metaphor, and they played a tough comeback game. They got to the point where they're going to get the ball with a chance to take the lead, which is all you can really hope for in the second half of a game. Keep it a one-score game and make your own breaks. A couple big plays for them. This big snap over the quarterback's head for Moapa Valley that gave them some momentum.
Yeah.
And then the long bomb.
Oh, to Trump. They brought him down to the 8-yard line.
The Jason bomb, long bomb of the first half where he boxed out and made that catch, gave him first and goal, and then gutsy call on the coach's part to go for it on fourth down, ended up giving him the touchdown that made it a 3-point game at halftime. So some mistakes on both sides, some great plays on both sides. The interception, the read that, what was his name, 55.
Oh, for Hurricane.
Yeah, for Hurricane that Trey Hershey made.
Yeah.
That was a great football play. That was a momentum changer and kept them in the game. So, I talked a couple times about that middle 4 minutes or middle 8 minutes. The middle 4 minutes were won by Hurricane. So if they can win the first 4 minutes of the second half, they'll put themselves in good position to win this game. So fun football game, fun high school football game. Some emotion, guys, we had a couple of unsportsmanlike penalties and those things that you get when you have young guys out playing the game, but entertaining, and the crowd's into it, and we're having a great time on a Friday night.
We are. We wouldn't want to be anywhere else, right?
Absolutely not.
I thought another key point was this: Hurricane in the second quarter was able to get stops on first down.
Yeah.
As the second quarter wore on, and it put Moapa Valley in second and long, third and long, to where they couldn't pick up that first down, and that's when the momentum started to
shift
a little bit.
Yeah, and for some reason, Moapa Valley went away from running with Matheson, who really he shouldered the whole load in the first quarter. And I don't know if Hurricane was doing some things scheme-wise to take his runs away, but the key to the second half is being able to contain him. I don't think they're going to be able to stop him.
Yeah.
But contain him and don't allow him to have any big plays, especially not, break off a long touchdown or something, because he's a game change kind of player. So that'll be key to him for them in the second half, is that to control on that, and then on the offensive side for Hurricane to continue to be able to make the plays that they've been making. Quarterback's been doing a really good job on those rollout passes to get his shoulders square and make the good throws. And Trump kid has done a really good job to get open and make some good catches.
Yeah, he really has. We've seen, you mentioned Gabriel, the quarterback for Hurricane, setting his shoulders on those rollouts. Those are key. Because as you know, if you don't set your shoulders, that ball's going to sail.
Ball sails, and those, especially on some of those short out routes, you sail the ball to a cornerback who's playing behind in coverage, and suddenly he's on the highlight reel.
Yeah.
So he's done a good job at the quarterback. I thought both lines, we talked about the line of scrimmage, and I thought the battle at the line of scrimmage was pretty one-sided in the first couple drives, but settled down to where they both have done a really good job at just slugging it out in the trenches. That the quarterback run by Gabriel for 3 yards, they opened up a nice seam for him and got him inside. So it's been fun to watch.
Yeah, it has. It really has. And I think you're right. They've really, the first quarter, I would say, like you mentioned, Moapa Valley, their line kind of controlled the quarter.
Yeah.
But then it was almost reverse script. Hurricane's line, both offensively and defensively, started to come around. They made some adjustments, and I think that's that's why they got that momentum going. So I think those are the key points that we probably should mention in the second half. But something else to think about, we need to be thinking of our Mountain Land Supply defensive play of the game. I think we got a couple of options there between the interception and some of the big hits we've seen. We got something else to be thinking of is our player of the game. So we might have a difficult time if this thing keeps going back and forth like it has.
Yeah, it has. It's been a, it's been what you wanted, what we talked about at the outset of this game, that you wanted to see some good high school football, and it's been that. It's there's been some good coaching decisions where the coaches had some tough choices to make. Some great plays by young players. A couple of mistakes. I think there's a one turnover each way, right?
Yeah. So the turnover, pretty clean.
Turnover game's pretty even. Had that one really nice play in the corner of the end zone down here where the Moapa Valley defender was able to rake the ball away from a receiver who looked like he had a touchdown. So, and that saved 4 points for them because that the play after that they kicked the field goal. So there's been some good plays, some mistakes. The long snap on the punt turned into a
six point
play. So that's a key to what's going on in the game right now. But it really is anybody's game. Coming out of halftime, we'll see who made better adjustments and who's hungrier and who picks up that momentum, especially who sets the tone as we get started. Those first 3 or 4 minutes of the second half are going to be key to see who's
I think you're
picks
right.
up the momentum.
It's going to be you know what we haven't seen tonight is a sack. We haven't seen any pressure on the two quarterbacks.
Yeah,
so.
Not really. We had the one down here, but that was a kind of a broken play. So
yeah.
there hasn't been a lot of pressure on the quarterback. We had the one time where we had the Hershey also put really good pressure on the Moapa Valley quarterback and made him overthrow his man downfield. But no pressure up the middle. Hasn't been a lot of passes thrown in the game, but the ones that have been thrown were key.
If you're hearing some noise in the background, the Hurricane students have gotten a little ruckus here on the bleachers, so we apologize if you're having a hard time hearing us. We've got just a couple of minutes before the second half will begin. What are some of the one last thing that you think that we need to really keep our eye on as far as moving into the second half? Do you think there's going to be any attrition due to the heat or anything that way, with Moapa Valley being their first game, or what are some of your keys that we think we should focus on here going into the second half?
You know, you worry about an August game down here in Utah's Dixie and in the desert. Moapa Valley's also from the desert, so they're used to it. Actually, for a game where we're, you know, middle of August.
Yeah.
The monsoon moisture that we've had the last couple days has kept the heat down. So I was just outside of the press box during halftime, and it's a really pleasant evening out there. So I don't think the heat's going to be a factor. Conditioning's always a factor in the second quarter, so we'll see who's been running harder. That could show up, especially as we talk about at the line of scrimmage with the offensive and defensive lines, which team is going to have that conditioning advantage in the fourth quarter to impose their will could be the deciding factor, could really make a difference in this game. So,
all right. Well, we'll keep an eye out for that. Just some scores from around the region, just to give people an update. It looks like Pine View and Canyon View are tied up at 28 all. That is in the third quarter. Up at Lehigh, we've got Desert Hills taking on Lehigh, and it's 17-0. For Lehigh. Juab and Cedar are playing. Cedar's up at Nephi tonight. They're 7-7 at halftime, so that's a slugfest there. And then 13-10, Bingham over Crimson Cliffs, so that's a close ball game at half up there in South Jordan.
That looks like Region 9 is representing well tonight, except Desert Hills. It needs to make a little comeback, but the Pioneers are tough. That's a really strong team there out of Lehigh. So Desert Hills has their work cut out for them. And but you know, they're not 17 nothing's not out of reach.
But, well, you're right. Lehigh, they've won the state championship 2 years ago in 5A. They won the 6A last year, so they've moved all the way up to the top division, and they've got things rolling up there. So that's a tough ball club, like you said.
Yeah, and it's tough to go up and play a team like that on the road too. And so I have to see how they respond, but everyone else seems to be in the region seems to be playing well, and we've got a heck of a ball game here. And you know, one score game, 2 minutes before the kickoff of the second half, it's anybody's game, and it's going to be fun to see who executes and who comes out and does the things that they've been working all summer to try and get done. So
this is why they lift those weights and run those sprints, right? Well, we'll take a quick two minute break, and we'll come back with the the second half kickoff right after this.
Hey, it's Sheldon Demke. Check out the latest episode of What's on the Menu, a behind-the-scenes tour of local restaurants. We'll see some of their favorite dishes and get an inside look on how these dishes are prepared. Check out this week's episode at stgeorgenews.com and click the shows on the menu tab.
Relatives coming to visit, not enough room, or maybe you're looking to host a family reunion and need a house with a pool? Well, Red Rock Vacation Rentals has got you covered. From 2-bedroom condos to 10-bedroom luxury homes, they truly have something for everyone. Plan your perfect getaway or staycation. Visit stgeorgeutahvacationrentals.com. There's not a bad seat in the house. It's From the Bleachers with Mark Musgrave and Caden Formaster on Fox Sports Southern Utah. Tune in weekdays from 4 to 6 for Region 10 high school sports, Utah Tech Athletics, NFL, NBA, MLB, and more. Region 10 Sports is brought to you by Nets on Fire, the premier training and event facility in Southern Utah. High-level individual and group training catered to your athlete, plus the best camps, clinics, tournaments, and showcases in the West. Visit netsonfire.org.
All right, we're back live here at Tiger Stadium in Hurricane, Utah. We're about to kick off here in the second half. It's Keith Curtis and Paul Valenzuela. Not Fernando Valenzuela, but Paul Valenzuela.
You know, the Dodgers, it might be tonight, very soon. It might be this week that the Dodgers are going to retire Fernando's number, put his number up in the Ring of Honor there at Chavez Ravine. And he's I'm a big Fernando Valenzuela fan, and so that's pretty cool to have that happen. I remember when he broke into Major League Baseball.
Oh, yeah.
And I was a 17-year-old kid, and Fernando Valenzuela was my major league hero. So that's a shout out to the Bull and to the Dodgers, and it's great that he's got his number retired. I wish the Riders would realize what an impact he had on baseball and put him in Cooperstown where he belongs.
Yeah, I agree with you. I was a kid too when he came up, and I remember the whole country got taken in, and you know, ESPN did, I think, had a nice 30 for 30 on him and kind of what he did for baseball in Mexico as well as other countries. It was just groundbreaking, and we've just seen it grow from there. Just a great pitcher. And the way he could turn his eyes on the mound and distract the hitter, it was unbelievable.
We were fortunate to live in Hermosillo, Mexico for a few years, and Fernando owns the Mexican League team in Navajoa, which is close by.
Okay.
And even as a 40, 50-year-old guy, he would still put himself in as a relief pitcher now and then because he knew that he would sell tickets. So,
sure.
You know, he owned that team, and he's been really good for the game of baseball in Mexico, and really good for the game for the Dodgers in Los Angeles, where they've got a big population of Hispanic people that love the fact. And he still does the color commentary for the Dodgers Spanish language broadcast.
Oh, he does. So, I didn't know that.
Yeah, he's still involved with the team, and
that's cool.
Well deserved that the Dodgers would retire number 34.
Well, we're ready to kick off here at start the third quarter. Back to kick for Moapa Valley is Cash Keller. Back to receive for the Tigers. It's number 22. And that's McRoberts, and he's got the left side. He breaks a tackle. He's going up the sideline, and he's bumped out of bounds about the 43-yard line. So great field position here to start the third quarter. There's that momentum shift right there.
Continuation of that second quarter momentum. So
McRoberts showed nice speed there too by the youngster getting up at the wide side of the field there and missing a few tackles. He's just a young sophomore. We've called a lot of young sophomores tonight.
We talked about their youth, so this is a kind of team that if Hurricane can develop these players over the next few years, they're going to be a force in the region and in the state because they've got a lot of young guys out here that are playing really well.
Well, that run was out to the 43-yard line, so it'll be first and 10. For the Tigers, they do a little ball swapping out there. I always thought that was interesting. And, you know, you have your kicking balls and, you know, yeah. A ball's a ball. Just leave it, you know. That's the way I used to look at it. But those kickers like certain ones. So yeah. Gabriel breaks the huddle. He's got Twins to the right. Sends Olds in motion. Fakes. Oh, he hands it to him. They try to do a reverse. The ball's on the ground. Moapa Valley falls on it. It's on the 31-yard line. So just like that, the momentum that was
just got tossed away. Good idea. That running a trick play right there is a good idea at the 43-yard line. But you have to execute. If you're going to take the chances, you got to execute.
Boy, and Paul, they had, if they could have got that cleanly, the right side was set up for a big gainer, too.
Yeah.
There was not a defender inside, and I think they might have got it inside the red zone, if not in the end zone.
Yeah,
but unfortunately, they put the ball on the carpet, and just like that, the momentum has been sucked out of the stadium.
Yeah, they got to buckle back up and get a stop on defense and keep this a one-score game.
Looks like we have an injured Pirate on the field from that pileup of the ball, but he's upstanding now, or trying to. There he goes. So he's that's number 54.
I think he was the player that recovered the fumble.
Gavin Frederick. So he got the worst end of that deal. He got the fumble, but he ended up with a cramp or cleat or something in the calf, it looked like.
Yeah.
With that said, Traft breaks the huddle, sends Twins to the right side. Two tight ends on the left. He's got Bradshaw next to him. He fakes the handoff, rolls to his left. Got pressured, and he's brought down by number 51 for Hurricane.
There's our first sack of the game.
Tight and right.
Like we talked about, got some pressure on him, and got a Scooter's Coffee sack.
That's right. Scooter's Coffee, the local coffee shop here in Hurricane. That's a 7-yard loss. That's a huge play there. Our 17-yard loss.
Yeah, that was he ran him down. I was a little worried that might be a horse collar, but he must have just got a handful of jersey and not shoulder pad.
Well, a big play nonetheless for the defense. So that's a great way of responding to the fumble and trying to get some of that momentum back. Schraft sends two to the short side of the field. He's barking for the ball, hands off to the running back. He eludes three tacklers, then gang tackled after about a 5-yard pickup. That, again, was Matheson. Boy, he is shifty in the backfield.
He had 8 yards after contact on that play. He got hit 3 yards in the backfield and made 5 yards.
Boy, he's got good feet, and he drug about 3 or 4 tacklers along the way. That'll bring up third and about 14 to go.
So it's what we talked about at halftime. They did a good job on first down to make it have a second and long, and turn that into a third and long, so hopefully they can get a stop and get the ball back.
So Schraft breaks the huddle, the ball on the 38-yard line, calls for the snap, fakes the handoff to Matheson, rolls to his left, throws back to the right side, almost a lateral, but it was well read by the defense, and
really
he's brought down for a 2-yard loss.
Yeah.
That was Langston, number 11,
yeah,
wasn't it?
Yeah, that made that. He's made a couple of really key plays.
Boy, he had that big hit at the
side.
End. Yeah, in the second quarter, and well read there. So that'll bring up fourth, and it looks like about 18, and they're going to kick it away, Paul.
Yeah, and they have to be careful because Matheson is the punter, and the last time he punted, he hesitated a little. Like if he saw a hole, he's not afraid to just turn and run.
Here's the snap back, and he does get it away, a spiral kick. It's going to bounce at the 6 and go out of bounds at the 2 or 3-yard line. Wow.
Great. In the old NFL, they used to call that a coffin corner kick.
Yeah.
And that was very well executed by Matheson. That doesn't seem to be anything he can't do.
No, he's a multifaceted player, that's for sure. It reminds me of the old Ray Guy punt. He used to be the master at doing that for the Oakland Raiders back in the day.
There's a reason why that punting award is named after him, because I can remember him as a force for the old Oakland Raiders.
Well, he would flip the field for him.
Yeah.
And he was just – and he had a leg like – I mean, I can remember seeing 60, 70-yard kicks. But here we are, 9:24 on the 3-yard line, the fake to Staples. He's going wide. He barely gets across.
He barely got out of the end zone on that. He ran a whole bunch of sideways to get the ball back out to the 1-yard line.
as a coach, you almost have a heart attack because you don't want to give up 2 points. But he stopped on the 1 yard line. There is a flag down. I wonder if it's a illegal shift before the play or what. But sideline warning. Wow. And that's on Moapa Valley. So play will stand. The ball is on the half yard line. So if you're a Hurricane fan, you really need to get some positive yardage.
Yeah, big down to get some push up front and get the ball removed from the line of scrimmage.
If not, you just make yourself trouble if you have to punt from that goal line.
Yeah.
So here we are, second down. Gabriel Calzer rolls left, fakes the throw. He's getting pressured in the end zone, gets outside of the end zone. Throws it away at the last minute while he's being wrapped up. I'm wondering if they're going to call him down. Boy, that was close to a safety.
Yeah, or intentional grounding if he didn't have a receiver out there. I didn't see.
There was one out there, but it was a ways away. They're wanting, Moapa Valley wants it, but doesn't look like they're going to give it to him. So that'll bring up third down and about 13 from the half-yard line. Boy, if you're Hurricane, you got to design something here that gets you some, at least some positive yards.
Yeah, get the ball out to the, at least to the 4 or 5 yard line, so your punter's not standing with his heels on the end line.
Even if it's 5 yards, 5 yards will give you the 15-yard cushion you need.
Yeah.
Hopefully they realize that, and the young quarterback can at least pick up 5-6 yards here to get help the punt team out. So Gabriel breaks the huddle and he sends three to the left. Got one to the right. That's Trump. Calls for the ball. And he's throwing a little swing pass up to Staples, who catches the ball.
Oh,
and he brings it in. Shoestring catch.
Shoestring catch.
Wow.
That's a tremendous play on to convert on third down and get them out of the shadow of their goalposts and back out on the field. That was a fantastic play.
An 18-yard pickup there by Staples. And, again, a beautiful catch. He was in full motion there, sprinting, and ball was underthrown. He made a great catch of the shoestrings, and what a great pickup for the offense for Hurricane.
Well-designed play to kind of take those matchups that they were in the defensive backfield and just run the guy by him, just kind of float the ball out there into that hole in the zone and pick up a first down.
So here's Gabriel with the handoff to fly sweep. Oh, he kept it. Goes up the middle. And he's going to pick up probably 5-6 yards. So, again, a good read on the fly sweep motion. And Gabriel picks his way up, gets 6 yards out of it. So that'll be second down and 4. So, again, 2 positive plays right now for the offense.
Looks like he got poked in the eye or something.
I'm wondering if his helmet come off and he's going to have to come out.
The referee stopped the clock on his timeout, so I think it was
a safety check type thing.
He had something physical check.
Okay. Well, that they'll now wind the clock, so there's 7:19 left here in the third quarter. Bring up second down and 4. And now we have another whistle. Gabriel barks the signals out, fakes the handoff, throws the little slant pass to and it went over his head. That was one where he didn't quite get his shoulder square, and
yeah,
just saw the ball raise.
Did sail a little high.
Well, he did have Olds open, though, in the middle of the field there on that quick slant.
That's one of those that we were talking about, that if Olds gets a hand on that and tips it up in the air, that can be trouble.
But yeah,
has to get those throws down and on his hands.
Yeah, as he gets older, too, the more reps he gets, he'll understand that the ball's got to be midsection down. If he has to go to the ground to catch it, so be it. You get a first down, and you move on. But that'll bring up third down now and a long 4. Gabriel calls for it, and he draws Moapa Valley off.
There's the old no play that we talked about. Get you
five cheap what yards
five cheap
right there.
Ones that I think they're still going to be about a yard short.
And, you know, as an offensive lineman, you really love that penalty, don't you?
Oh, yeah. 3rd and 1 compared to 3rd and 6 is a big difference.
Well, now the whole playbook is open, and it looks like, yeah, they are inches away, or are they not?
They're giving them the first down. So okay. They must have been just under 5 yards. So that's a nice first down conversion without having to do anything. So,
well, it makes the game a little bit easier to play, doesn't it?
It does. And so give another shout out to Tom Crittenden, who taught me that no play was one of the best plays in a high school book playbook.
Well, Gabriel takes the snap, hands off to the running back, number 34, goes to the short side of the field. He keeps his feet moving, gets about 8-9 yards. So a nice, nice pickup that time by the fullback. That is Connor Clyde on the carry.
Yeah, and Tuane was out there in front of him again, giving him a big 270-pound escort around that corner. So,
oh, they gave him 10 yards, so they get another first down on that carry. So starting on the half-yard line, Paul, and moving it all the way out to the 39, it's been real positive so far.
Yeah.
Here's Gabriel with the handoff again. This time it's the same play.
A little pursuit from behind that time. That play was slower to develop, so Tuane was out there in front but couldn't get turned up the corner, and the linebacker scraped in from the backside and made the tackle on that.
Yeah, that was Ryan Bellavance. We mentioned him in the pregame show. Yeah. He's the middle linebacker, and he came in and dropped him for no gain, so a great play, as you mentioned. Went to the well one too many times in a row there, it looks like. Yeah.
And once again, I like that play to the wide side.
Yeah. Gabriel breaks the huddle, gets the fly sweep action. He's going wide. That's number 7. It takes a mean hit out there by number 4. We've seen him lay the lumber, Tyson Redd.
Tyson Redd, yeah. He's made some really nice plays, and he did right there. Brings up a 3rd and long. This is a big play in this drive.
I'm telling you, Hunter Prince is going to say, don't give me that ball. Keep it and run up the middle. That Dyson can lay the lumber. So 3rd and a long 6 now with 5:44 here to go in the third quarter. Hurricane trailing 10-13. But again, this has already been a positive drive, moving this from the half-yard line out. Gabriel takes the snap, rolls to his right, throws to the flat, and he hits number 7. That is Prince, and he's driven backwards after a small gain of only about 2 yards.
So yeah, Mark Villa or Villa came up there on that and had the coverage, made a sure tackle. So,
well, it looks like Kern is willing to punt at this time as we go to 5 minutes left here in the third quarter. They bring in the kicker. That's Langston.
Right now would be a good time for no play again. It'd give you a first down if you get him to jump.
Try to get a free 5 yards out of it. Here's the snap. It's a good snap. Back to Langston. He gets the ball in the air. Good punt. And a fair catch made by Matheson down at the 25-yard line.
So they didn't score on that drive, but they did flip the field. I mean, they started with the ball way back in their own end, and they were able to drive the ball out to the 45-yard line, get a decent punt, turn the field around so that their defense comes back on the field. Their defense got some rest. So not the drive that they were looking for to tie or take the lead, but they did some positive things on that drive.
Very positive. You're absolutely right. And, you know, to be able to flip the field, like you said, that was the key. Because if you end up giving Moapa Valley a short field, you know, now they got to go 75 yards to score, whereas before it looked like you only need to go about 35.
Yeah. Well, after the turnover, they had the ball on a very short field.
Yeah.
They were able to keep them from scoring, get the ball back, and they've done some good things on offense. Looked good.
So Schraff for the Pirates hands off to the running back, number 1. That is Matheson, and he picks up about 2 or 3 yards. Again, not a bad defensive play that time by Hurricane.
That's about the best they've defended him all night, was on that play, and he still got 3 yards because he runs leaning forward and looking upfield for sure.
That'll bring up 2nd down and about 7 to go. But again, I like what Hurricane's doing on defense, making it 2nd and longer.
Yeah, it hasn't been 2nd and 2 or 2nd and 3. They've done a good job on those first downs.
So Schraft clapping for the ball. Here's a double reverse inside, trapped. They hand it off to Anderson, then they give it off to number 42 for Moapa Valley, and he breaks a couple of tackles.
This official threw a flag for face masking that wasn't a face mask. It's too bad we don't have our replay, but
need our replay guy to send him a signal.
He did. He did slap him across the top of his helmet, but he didn't grab the face mask, and they're going to give him 15 extra yards.
That was Caden Rawson, 42 on the carry. He got about 15 yards on the carry.
Yeah, and they're going to give him 15 more.
So that'll be a 30-yard net gain on that play. Boy, that's a long, slow-developing play, but it's a trick play in a way. You've got the, you know, the fly sweep motion.
Yeah.
And then you turn around and give it to the tight end.
That inside counter. And that's the play they ran successfully in the first quarter, and they've kind of gone back to that. They haven't done it a whole bunch since then. And unfortunate that they had that penalty called. I didn't see. It didn't look to me like he grabbed his face mask, but he did slap him across the face, and sometimes that was certainly enough on that play to get the flag to come out.
So Schraff breaks the huddle. He moves the two tight ends from the right side to the left. He's got twins to the right. He rolls to the right. He fires the ball in the flat, a little high, but it is caught by number 11. That is Jacob Dominguez, and he will pick up about four yards on the catch.
Yeah, so that was a positive first down play for them.
We haven't seen that very much tonight, where they roll out Schraft and give him options. So that'll bring up a second down and let's say 6 yards to go with 3:10 here left in the third quarter. Schraff barking out the plays. He's got single receivers on each side. Hands off the ball to Matheson, who cuts it upfield, and he'll get about 3 yards. So they'll bring up third down and two from the Hurricane 32 yard line.
Yeah, and that's going to be four down territory for Moapa here, so they need to stiffen up on the defense. They've done a better job in the third quarter of tackling Matheson than they did in the first half, but he's still, you know, every time he touches the ball, he seems to get his 3 or 4 yards.
Well, if you're Hurricane here, as the defense coordinator, do you think they slant them to try to get and guess which way they're going, or what would you do here, Paul?
You could take a chance and try to get into those gaps and confuse the offensive line a little bit.
So here's the snap. They do a little flat pass to Matheson, who falls forward. Lucky he held on to it, but he's going to pick up the first down. He got 3 yards, so that'll be a first down from the 29-yard line for the Pirates.
Yeah, that was Brigham Kemp from Hurricane read that and jumped the route and just kind of missed. He kind of went for the interception, and the ball got past him. So
yeah, almost a big play there, but with that said, it's a big first down pickup for the Pirates as they keep moving down closer to that red zone area. So they're taking a little more time now on this play call. A little question by Matheson, and they rush up to the line. They're going to have to hurry to get this one off, but Schraff's calling out the play. He's got, looks to his right, goes out to Matheson, but that's well underthrown. That looked like that was just a mix-up happening from the beginning.
Yeah, that, a little confusion. Matheson didn't know if he was supposed to be on the field, then he came on, and then the throw was one of those where it looked like the quarterback was unsure of what he was supposed to be doing with it. So,
not the cleanest possession, that last play, but that'll bring up second down and 10 here at the 29-yard line. They were running players on and off the sideline there before that last play, so very fortunate that something bad didn't happen to him.
Yeah, we've used up almost all of the third quarter and still where we were when we came out at halftime. So
both defenses are stiffened, that's for sure. Here's Schrafty. You got two receivers, one to each side. Handoff is to the running back, going wide, doing the fly sweep. And he's extending the play, breaks two or three tackles, then gets driven out of bounds. That's number 29, Brody Redd. He's a young sophomore for Moapa Valley. And he'll pick up 6 yards for a first down.
I think they gave him like 12 yards on that. He did a good job when he got to the sideline to turn upfield, stay in bounds, and get 5 or 6 extra yards, because it looked like he was going to be run out of bounds after a 4 or 5 yard gain.
Well, that's a great run by Red. He just kept stringing it out, waiting for that hole to happen. He finally saw a little crease, and he hit it hard. So that's first down 10, from the 19.
Just in the red zone.
Yeah, in the Cache Valley Bank red zone. So Schraft is calling for the play. He's got one to his wide side. Here's the handoff up the middle. Again, that's number 29. He's being drugged by number 16 for the Tigers, just dragging defenders. That's Brody Red going down inside almost to the 10-yard line. So a good gain on first down.
Yeah, that opens the playbook up for Moapa Valley, second and two or second and one. There's a lot more things you can do as the offensive coordinator than what you can do on second and 10.
Yeah, it gives you a lot of options, doesn't it? So Schraff breaks the huddle. He's got two to his right on the wide side of the field, and now they move the tight end, two tight ends to the right side. Here's the handoff to Matheson. He cuts upfield, and he's going to walk into the end zone almost untouched. From 9 yards out, Moapa Valley will get on the board with a touchdown.
Yeah, that drive looked a lot like the first drive of the first quarter as far as the play selection that they did and that counter play that they were running inside and then that power that they just ran to score the touchdown. So
it's almost like they've went back to the script of what they had their first 10 plays of the game. And
that's maybe what they talked about when they made their halftime adjustments was, you know, what was working for us early in the game.
Yeah.
We kind of got away from that. We need to go back to it because that's what that drive looked like, was very, very much like the first drive of the game.
Well, here the Pirates come out. They're going to go for two. Here's the direct snap to Matheson. He's the jump pass, and he's got it complete. That's the number 80, Davis Contop, and that will give them two more points. So that'll make it 21-10 for the Pirates. So
yeah, number 68 was standing 5 yards deep in the end zone, and the refs didn't pay attention to him.
Oh, offensively.
Yeah, the right guard. He was running a stop route. looked like Dalton Kincaid, but
with the Utes, huh?
Yeah.
Well, with 49 seconds left in the third quarter, we'll take a break with the score 21-10. Moapa Valley, we'll be right back.
This cheesesteak is so freshly grilled, you can still hear it sizzling.
I can hear it, too.
Me, too.
Actually, it's the...
Hello? Cheesesteak?
Grilled
right in front of you. It's a Jersey Mike's thing.
Create your own relaxing, comfortable space. Boulevard Home offers the guaranteed best prices on furniture, appliances, mattresses, and more. And buy with no interest financing. Shop Boulevard Home, because home is who we are.
All right, welcome back to Tiger Stadium with the kickoff here. And the ball is in the air. It's going to come down short at about the 20. It bounces, and the Hurricane players have to jump on it. That could have been disastrous as Moapa Valley was right there. So Hurricane will get the ball first and 10 on about the 23-yard line.
Yeah,
Paul. Sorry.
Good coaching to have that kid just come up and recover the ball rather than try and pick it up and do something with it.
How many times have you seen somebody flying up there as fast as they can and slip through their
fingers?
Thinking
they're going to scoop it up and kicking it or missing it. So that was good to just cover it up, get your offense on the field.
Well, that'll bring the Hurricane offense out on the field, back out on the field. They send trips to the wide side, one to the short side of the field. Gabriel rolls to the right, looking back left, getting pressured. He avoids pressure, now turns it upfield, goes back to the short side, and he's going to pick up about 16, 17 yards on the quarterback scramble.
Yeah, that's... One of the dangers of playing man-to-man is if the quarterback breaks contain, he's got a long way to run, and that was a nice run by the quarterback.
And there was good pressure that time by Gary Levin, number 55 for Moapa Valley. He just Gabriel just slipped underneath him and took off running. He's got good speed.
Pretty good, yeah. He looked had pretty good wheels to get up the sideline there and get a big gain, which was important.
So that'll take the ball up to the 40-yard line. First and 10. Since Twins to the right, wide side. Twins to the left. He's got Stables to the right side. Gabriel does. He's barking out signals, calling for the ball. Hands off. No, he fakes it. Goes to Trump. And that ball's behind Trump. Boy, that went in the air. That could have been picked off.
That was one of those that makes you a little nervous. Yeah, it was a little bit hurried to throw a little bit and got it behind him. But it was a nice thought. Get that ball out on his front hand so he can run with the ball when he catches it.
Trump was open. Gabriel just needs to set his feet a little bit more better, square the shoulders up. He had good zip on it, but because he was kind of off balance, the throw was off course. So they go back to second down and 10. Here's the snap. This time he fakes again to Steeples. Ball's tipped by number 55 by Moapa. And that was Gary Levitt. We mentioned him earlier. He got his hands on the ball, and that'll bring up third down and 10.
I was fortunate to not catch that one because it would have been a two-yard loss if he had caught it. But yeah, that's we're talking before about the Hurricane getting Moapa Valley behind the chains, and that miss on first down put them in a second and short.
Yeah.
Missed the pass again. Now they're in a third and long.
So Gabriel calls for the ball, rolls right. He's looking, goes deep down the sideline, and it's in between two receivers. So falls to the turf, free and complete. That'll bring up fourth down and 10 with 35 seconds left here in the third quarter.
Yeah, that drive had the one positive play on the quarterback scramble for a nice gain, and then basically a three and out after that. So hopefully get a good punt, but that's running out of time in the third quarter and still down two scores.
Here's a Region 9 score update from Canyon View High School. Looks like Canyon View is up 42-28 over Pine View. So there's 8 minutes left in that game. Lehigh is up 24-7 on Desert Hills. Here's the punt. Down by Hurricane, and good coverage by the Tigers as it's brought down at the 42-yard line. So with 26 seconds left in the third quarter, we'll stay right here till the end of the quarter, then we'll take a commercial break. Paul, we need, from Hurricane, we need these students to get back into the game, get a little louder, and get a big play here.
Yeah, they need to. The third quarter's been a stalemate, and in a game when you're ahead, that turns into a win for Moapa Valley. So the kind of that momentum, the energy that was in the stadium going into halftime and coming out of halftime, the turnover kind of took that and flattened the enthusiasm of the crowd, and a big play, a turnover, a sack, one of those kind of chaos plays would be very appropriate right now for Hurricane to get themselves back into this game. They certainly can't allow another score to go down three scores.
No, they'll be in trouble.
Heading into the fourth quarter.
Here is a handoff, direct handoff to number 12. That goes to Mateo Bradshaw, and he is rocked by number 33. That is Connor Clyde. No, excuse me. Not Connor Clyde. That's Titan. Right? No, it's not. I can't even read.
Brian Ireland.
Ireland.
I think
that's right.
He put a lick on. He was running through that hole, and he thought he was going to go somewhere, and suddenly he stopped. So.
Sorry for the folks at home. I gotta get a clear roster. It's too light for me.
It's too hard to see on that red paper. But
well, that's the end of the third quarter. We'll take a quick break, a two-minute break, and then we'll be back with the fourth quarter right after this.
Growing, and we're growing too. What started on the U of U campus has grown to over 110,000 members with 20 locations, and we're ready to meet even more of you. More than a campus or a branch, we are Utah's teachers, businesses, and families. For over 65 years, we've been part of your community, and while our name is changing, our commitment to you is not. University Credit Union is now U First Credit Union. See why it's getting even better here. Welcome to U First.
Here at Tiger Stadium here in Hurricane. We're bringing up a second down and 4 as we start the fourth quarter. Traft calls for the ball, fakes the handoff. He's going to keep it himself, goes right up the middle, and he's brought down by the middle linebacker, number 33, Ireland, but not until Traft picks up 6 yards and a first down.
Looks like they marked him just short of the first down, so it's going to bring up third down and 2 feet.
Man, Paul, I'm looking at the screen, and I could have swore. Oh, they just moved the ball back.
It looked to me like he had gotten the first down, but that official on the far side had a spot that he liked, and that's where they put the ball. So.
All right. Well, he fell across the line. I thought for sure he had it. But with that said, it's third and one. And they're going to go Wildcat right now with Matheson playing quarterback. He gets the ball, goes up the left side. He's got a big hole. He's still churning the feet down to the 40-yard line. So a big run of 9 yards. Good hard run by Matheson.
Yeah, that's one of those where you line up and say, we're going to do this, see what you can do about it, and see if you can stop it. And Matheson is a good runner, and that Wildcat formation gives them an extra blocker when they run that power off that left side, and that was a well-designed play and well-executed. So
starting to feel the dominance of their O-line.
Yeah, that's they've had the better push late in the third quarter. It was a stalemate early, but it's Moapa's kind of started to win the line of scrimmage as we've gotten later in this game.
Here's the handoff from Schraff to looks like that to Bradshaw. He goes up the left side, and he's going to pick up 8, 9, maybe 10 yards again. So,
yeah, and that was one. If you look at the left guard and the left tackle, they both pulled out in front of that play and put a double team on the linebacker who was trying to scrape over, and two on one. It was a mismatch, and they did a good job again at the line of scrimmage.
Well, and they're utilizing the wide side of the field, too, where they can stretch these smaller defenders of Hurricane out, giving them running lanes to pick and choose from. So here's Schraft in the huddle. He breaks it. He calls for the ball, fakes the – here's the inside trap, and it's number 42.
That's different runner, yeah.
Caden Rawson. We haven't seen him before. And again, it's that old counter tray, inside counter tray action. Slow developing, but very effective as they pick up another 7, 8 yards. They're down to the 24-yard line.
Yeah, that Moapa's running the ball on almost every play. The old strategy, when you have a lead in the fourth quarter, you try to shorten the game and lengthen the lead and run the ball a bunch, and that's what they're trying to do right here.
Well, they're executing really well right now, picking up large chunks of yardage. Here's Schraft. He hands off to the end, who gets met after a short gain. Nice tackle.
Yeah, that was a good stop to make it second and long.
That looked like number 23, Carson Walker. He's a young sophomore as well.
Yeah, Hurricanes played hard, and they've played well. This has been especially for an early season high school football game, it's been a tough played game, well-played game, and These young Hurricane players have really come out and played hard-nosed football, which is what you want to see out of them.
Yeah, you really do, especially this young. Here's Schraff moving the ends from right to left. He hands off to Matheson, who takes it, cuts up field, and again picks up about 4 or 5 yards. That'll bring up third and about 2.5, 3 yards for the first down. We are inside the red zone, the Cache Valley Bank red zone. Are the Pirates with 9 minutes left here in the fourth quarter.
Yeah, he planted his left foot on that one. He was 6 yards upfield before anybody could see what had happened. He got the ball going laterally, saw the hole, and he was decisive, planted his foot, and just went.
Well, and as you mentioned, Paul, you're kind of feeling the shortening of the game here because we're already under 9 minutes.
Yeah.
They're taking their time in between plays. They move both tight ends to the wide side here. Schraff takes it, hands off, fake the... Oh, they do the reverse. That's to number 4, Tyson Redd, and he picks up 6 yards. So bring up first down from about the 7-yard line.
Yeah, getting first down in 3 plays, taking a minute or a minute and a half off of every cycle of that, moving the ball just methodically down the field. This is textbook what you want to do from an offensive perspective with an 11-point lead in the fourth quarter.
Well, and it's what it does, too, to the defense. It's demoralizing.
Yeah, it wears them out.
Yeah. So that brings Schraft out of the huddle here. He's got one wide right on the wide side of the field. He hands off to Matheson. He cuts up field. And a good job this time.
Nice job.
By the Tiger defense. Holding him to no gain.
Yeah, that was Curtis Barlow, just kind of stepped up under the blocks and got right in. And, you know, that Matheson's tough to tackle, and that was a sure tackle on him. got his shoulder pads right in the middle of his at his belt line and brought him down.
Well, and if you don't tackle him squarely, he'll juke you or break out of it. He's a tough runner, so great job there on the execution of the tackle. That'll bring up second down and goal from, or excuse me, second down and about eight from the 10-yard line. Schraft calling out the plays. He hands off to Matheson. Plants that left foot, gets upfield again. He gets grinding down to the 5-yard line. So that'll bring it up to third down and about 3 yards.
Yeah, this is the 3 yards in a cloud of dust drive for sure.
This is the old Big Ten football at its best.
Bo Schembechler somewhere is smiling.
Yeah. Him and Woody Hayes are watching it together.
So. Yeah, I'm sure they're watching together.
Well, we're inside of 7 minutes now, 6:40 left on the clock here in the fourth quarter. Moapa Valley Pirates are on the 5-yard line, third down and 3. This is definitely probably 2-down territory if they don't pick it up. Looks like they're going to run this all the way down and call a timeout here. With 6:25 on the clock, they call timeout.
Yeah, they've been taking, like I said, every three plays that they're moving the chains, they're taking a minute and a half off the clock, so they've really done a good job to consume a bunch of clock and a bunch of yards, and they're in a really good position right now to score. If they score another touchdown right here and, you know, go ahead by 18 points, that's a 3-score game with not a lot of time left.
Yeah, so it's going to be a long haul to go, that's for sure. You know, I'm really impressed with Coach Brent Lewis from Moapa Valley reverting back to what worked in that first quarter and really just, you know, going back kind of old school and saying, look, I'm going to put a hat on a hat and we're going to move you around, and if you can stop us, stop us. I mean, they haven't been able to.
Yeah, a lot of those things we talked about at halftime as far as conditioning and who could dominate the line of scrimmage late in the game, and this drive has been completely dominated by the offensive line from Moapa Valley, and then they got those good strong runners behind them, and that's this drive is the drive that's determining the difference of this game right now.
Well, it'll be third down and 3 as they approach the ball now out of the timeout. They'll send one receiver to the short side, one to the wide side. They've got two tight ends on the left side. Looks like Bradshaw, the running back, is to the left of Schraft. And it's just a direct snap. Oh, it's the Wildcat, and that's Matheson. He's into the end zone for a touchdown. He was not going to be denied.
Yeah, they outnumber him when they run that play, and they've got a good strong runner behind that. Overload that one side, and that's 4 or 5 times they've run that play on short yardage situations and down near the goal line where it's really paid off for them.
So with 6:20 left on the clock here in the fourth quarter, the Pirates from Moapa Valley are up 27-10 with the extra point pending. Keller, the kicker for the Pirates, has set. Here is the snap. Low snap bobbled. Matheson picks it up, looks to throw it, and he's thrown down for a loss. So good job by the Hurricane defense there to deny the extra point. So we'll take a break with our score, 6:20 left here. It's 27 for the Pirates of Moapa Valley to 10 of the Hurricane Tigers. We'll be right back, right after this. Yeah, one. Yep.
Hey, it's Sheldon Demke. Check out the latest episode of What's on the Menu, a behind-the-scenes tour of local restaurants. We'll see some of their favorite dishes and get an inside look on how these dishes are prepared. Check out this week's episode at stgeorgenews.com and click the shows on the menu tab.
From your first real leap of faith, your first growing pains, your first big dream come true, we're here. Through all of your firsts, U First Credit Union is here for you. Come grow with us.
All right, we're back here at Tiger Stadium here in Hurricane. We are approaching the end of the fourth quarter here with a score of 27-10 for the visiting team from Moapa Valley.
Yeah, that last drive was one that, as an offensive lineman, that's the the lineman's dream if you're from Moapa Valley, where you just kind of tell the coach, put this on our backs. I don't know that they threw the ball on that drive, did they?
No.
I think they run pretty much all running plays and just kind of stuffed the ball right down their throats and did what they wanted to with it. Now they've got Hurricane back against the wall where they're going to have to pull out the stops and get some big plays like that great kickoff return.
Yeah, unfortunately, it's going to be negated as there's a penalty flag back on the 24-yard line.
Oh, that's too bad.
That was taken by McRoberts. He's had a couple of good returns tonight. You know, again, we're talking about some players from Hurricane where you're hearing their name a lot. They're just young sophomores getting a lot of valuable varsity time. So I only can imagine what it's going to do for their confidence when they hit senior year, that's for sure.
Yeah, and they'll learn a lot from these games and learn some from this fourth quarter. Hopefully they'll learn some things about conditioning because we talked a lot about conditioning and getting into the fourth quarter, and so far getting into this fourth quarter that the line of scrimmage has been dominated by the team in white.
Yes, it has. Yep, it has. We talked about it in the beginning of the game. Their size difference isn't a lot there. I mean, it's pretty equal as far as the size discrepancy goes up front. I think it's just there's been a little more grit and a little more toughness coming from the Moapa side, and it's really raised up, especially from the middle of the third quarter to now.
Yeah, and you look at Moapa's roster, and they're all juniors and seniors. I think they only traveled one sophomore to this game tonight. So they're more experienced and they're an older team. So boy, that's a penalty piling on penalty because they had the holding during the play and then they had a dead ball personal foul.
Oh wow!
After, so that's
that'll take them all the way back to what, inside the 10-yard line.
Yeah, they're going to be way backed up.
Well, they were on the half-yard line the last drive and was able to pop it out of there. They're now inside the 7-yard line.
And they have 93 yards to go to get this game back to a two-score game. So there got to be some big, nice pass plays if they're going to make any kind of a run at them.
Well, Gabriel sends the man in motion, fakes the fly sweep. There's a fumble. He picks it up. And he runs forward and is able to get positive yards out of it. So that almost disastrous play that time. That was Hunter Prince, a mix-up between Gabriel and him. And very fortunate that they didn't have a turnover there. A
couple of those ball handling errors that they had, like on the trick play they tried to run right after halftime, have really hurt them. So one of the things they can work on in practice is just getting clean handoffs and clean transfers of the ball. They do a lot of lateral moves and those kinds of things, and those don't work if you're not getting nice, good, clean handoffs. So,
yeah, and that's all about repetition, isn't it?
Yeah, and again, we talk about their young guys, but the coaching staff can see this film and focus on and say we made some mistakes where just cleanly handling the ball would have helped us and work on that in practice as they get ready to go into their region schedule.
Well, the reason for our delay here, folks, we had an injury on number 50 for Moapa Valley, Ryan Belevance. He had a cramp, it looks like, but he's all right. He's off the field now, so it'll start the clock here. And got 5:29 left here in the fourth quarter as Hurricane sends trips to the right side of the field, the wide side. And they'll put Staples next to Gabriel on the right as well. Now there's some confusion. Gabriel with the umpire saying, what's the deal with the clock? Or I don't know what he's arguing about. The umpire's saying he was tackled inbounds, son. We got to run the clock.
Yeah.
Looks like they're going to change the time on the clock to 5. Well, I don't know. Now there's a discussion with the coach. So I don't know. Maybe they're having dinner plans. I don't know what they're doing, Paul.
Yeah, they're trying to put a few seconds back on the clock, I think, because
Well, I just got a Region 9 update from Cedar City. Canyon View is up 49, Pine View 41. 4:43 left.
Got a barn burner going.
My goodness, that's a lot of points.
That sounds like a lot of fun for an old offensive lineman.
Yeah. That game was played at Southern Utah University as the Pine or Canyon View field got so much water they couldn't play on it. It would have just ruined it. So they moved it to the college, which is cool for the high schoolers.
Yeah, that's fun.
So they got a lot of points going on, so that would be a fun atmosphere there. So here's Gabriel back to pass, rolls to his right, fakes, throws deep down the middle of the field, and there's Matheson, the free safety, right there for the interception. So not only can he run the ball, but he can play free safety as well.
Yeah, he's... I think if we were going to pick a player of the game so far, we know the one that scored three or four touchdowns and just had an interception. So,
well, I don't want...
He's had a heck of a game.
I know we're not to that point of the game, but the Hurst Ace Hardware player of the game right now, it's going to be hard to beat Shannon Matheson. I'll bet he's well over 125 yards rushing.
Yeah.
He's got three touchdowns, an interception. He's just done it all
tonight.
He's the punter. Yeah, he did the coffin corner kick, put him on the 3-yard line. I mean, he does it all.
His mom brought the orange slices at halftime.
Oh, man. There's the snap. Handoff is to number 29. That is Brody Red. He's one of those young sophomores right there that made the trip up, and he picks up almost 7 yards. So, again, just a good push on that right side, on the wide side of the field. And Red made good yardage.
Yeah, and where Hurricane was getting those stops and making it 2nd and 9 or 2nd and 10 late in the second quarter, and as we've gotten further into this game, their first downs are 6-7 yards.
Yeah.
And it's just making it possible for them to just eat clock, continue to move the chains, and they really have – dominated since they scored that touchdown to make it a 2-score game. They've not done much. Hurricane has not done as much on defense.
Here's the handoff to number 42, and he's still got the pile moving. He got the first down and probably drug about 10 defenders. That's Caden Rawson, again another young sophomore for Moapa Valley, picking up about 23 yards on the carry. So a nice strong run. He went left, cut back right, found a big gap in the middle of the field, and drug the team with him.
Yeah, and Moapa seems to have been, they brought those sophomores with them for a reason, and they're letting them get some snaps with the varsity team, and that's how you build your team for the future, is develop your players, your young guys, and when you get a lead like this, have a chance to get them in the game and get them some reps.
It's really smart by the coaching staff. Here's Schraft in the shotgun. He hands off to number 29. He gets stood up, and a great tackle that time by number 51 for for Hurricane. But now they're going to call unnecessary roughness or something. We got some chippiness going on, which will only give more yardage to the Pirates.
Yeah, I think he did a little bit of a flex after that tackle. And
you know, back in the day, they would just say, you know, you might want to look at the scoreboard before you do that.
the old umpires would just walk up to you and pat you on the head and say, you know, son, it's settled down some.
Yeah. It's like they'd go, really? Matt Hamlin over there, our producer tonight. We got to give a big shout out to him and Gage, our cameraman. They've done an excellent job tonight. What a beautiful night here in August. Usually it's 95 to 100 degrees here in the press box, but tonight it's been a cool 83 degrees. It's been wonderful. It's all due to Matt Hamlin and Gage and our crew. They've done such a great job. I want a big shout out to them. So it looks like it's going to go.
They called it the other way. So he must have said something after he got up from that pile drive because that moved him backwards.
Oh, so a 15-yard unsportsmanlike against the Pirates, which might be a benefit in this game because now they have more field they can run the ball and maybe run the clock out.
Yeah, it's Hurricane is, you know, their window of opportunity kind of went away as they gave up all those rushing yards, really, in the fourth quarter.
So here is rolling right or left on the pass play, and then the throw is out in the flat to number 42. That's, again, that young sophomore, Caden Rawson, went through his hands. A little surprised that they got Schraff throwing the ball.
Yeah, that's the first throw they've, in probably 15 offensive plays, that's the first time they've thrown the ball. So.
Well, that'll bring up third down and about 16, 17 yards to go. I think Schraff's had a pretty decent night. I don't think he's thrown the ball more than, what, maybe 10 times, if that?
Yeah, but he's been effective on some of the passes that he's thrown, and they had a good game plan, and they went back to it in that third and fourth quarter, and it really made a difference.
It sure did. Here's Schraff barking out the signal, the handoff, going on the wide sweep. Number 29 is, slips one tackle, and then he's gang tackled after picking up about almost 10 yards. So great run that time by Brody Red, number 29.
And fourth down, and there looks like they just leave the offense on the field, right?
Yeah. If I'm Coach Lewis, I just run my stuff, and if they stop me, they stop me. If they don't, they don't, you know.
Somebody called a timeout. Was that
That was our friends at Hurricane.
You know, you look at this game, and the first half was 13-10. The second half is 14-0. So
yeah,
it's
And to be honest with you, Paul, I think the play that backfired on them was the reverse.
Yeah, trying that.
They had the momentum. Play. They tried the trick play. And the trick play killed him. And it sucked all the life out, not out of the team, but also out of the stand. We haven't heard the students. We haven't heard them really getting into it since then.
Yeah, they had their chances in this game. And it was a well-played game. And one team did the things we talked about at halftime. Came out and took control of the line of scrimmage. Better conditioning, especially up front. And ran the ball a ton and ate a bunch of clock as they extended their lead, and that's why we sit here with 3 minutes left in a game that unfortunately is going to look a lot more like a blowout than it is, because it was a much closer game than the score is going to show, really.
It really was. It's amazing, though, how old school football comes back into play, you know, when it's managed right, and, you know, like you said, Coach Lewis has done. So here's fourth down and 10 yards to go. They send Matheson in motion. Here's pressure off the left side. Throw down the middle of the field, and it's caught for a touchdown. It's caught, number 80. That is Davis Contop. He was the one that was wide open earlier in the first half. He got his payback right there. Well, that was a heck of a catch. He was well defended.
Well defended, and the defender had his hands in his face trying to block his vision and keep him from catching the ball, but he just, great concentration, great hands, right at the back of the end zone, kept his feet in bounds, made a nice catch, made a nice touchdown.
Yeah, that was a heck of a catch. Contop, he's a senior. He'll remember that one. He'll be telling his kids and his grandkids, you know, 35 years from now. I had one toe in and, you know, defender all over me.
Absolutely.
Pulling on my jersey. Here's the extra point attempt, and boy, he got a foot into that one. We hadn't seen that one all night. That one almost went to the scoreboard.
Yep.
So with 3:09 left here in the fourth quarter, we'll take a quick timeout. The score is 34-10 in favor of the Pirates. We'll be right back.
We love giving back to our community, and over the years, we have provided vehicles for families in need, supported local charities, and helped train our first responders. Dealer Collision, your place for collision repair.
And And we're back live here at Tiger Stadium in beautiful Hurricane, Utah. A beautiful night for football. The Moapa Valley Pirates have come into Hurricane tonight and in the second half really have established some dominance up front. They've now scored on three straight possessions. Here's the kickoff, and it's chipped down to the 25-yard line. It bounces, and it's picked up by Hurricane. They're going to go back to the wide side, and he cuts up field. He's picked up 10, 15, 20 yards out to midfield, and a great return that time by the young sophomore, number 22. That is Mick Roberts. He's got some explosiveness to him.
Yeah, and he's done a really good job on the special teams all night on those returns and giving them good field position.
It looks like the umpire and the ref is discussing here. I don't know if there's some laundry on the field or not. Might be another sideline warning. They're pointing to the sideline here.
Yeah, I don't see any flags back behind the play, so maybe it was something at the right at where they made the tackle.
So he's right at midfield. There's 3 minutes left here in the fourth quarter. You know, I'll give it to these students from Hurricane. They're not going home. They're still here supporting their team and
making the press box shake.
Yeah, they're still shaking the benches a little bit. You go over to the Moapa side, and they've actually had a good turnout come up from Overton area down there.
Yeah, they got a good crowd. Boy, they really moved them back from the must have been a personal foul right out there near the.
Well, that moves them all the way back from the 50 to the 35.
So it was some form of 15-yard penalty, either unsportsmanlike or a personal foul. That
or if there was a hold at the 45.
That was a little short of that. But
whatever it might be, we're not going to speculate any longer. Here comes the Hurricane offense out. Gabriel still in at quarterback. Fakes the throw to the flat, rolling right, throws now to the flat to Staples, avoids one tackler and gets tripped up that time by number 44 for Moapa Valley, and that is Brandon Levitt, a junior wide receiver slash linebacker. You know, I'm impressed with Moapa Valley's conditioning. They only have 32 guys here.
Yeah.
And you know, a lot of them go both ways, and they seem to be handling it really well. Here is the rollout right. He throws left, and the pass is caught down there for Hurricane. That's number 9 for the Tigers, down all the way to the 34-yard line. Number 9, that is Riley Thompson.
Riley Timpson.
Or Timpson. So great throw and catch there.
Yeah, kind of threw that into traffic, but he got it right to his guy, so.
Gabriel gets the snap. He's now flush from the pocket, rolls left. He's now headed upfield, and there's a block. They're probably getting in the back before he runs out of bounds. No, they say he got his head across. So he gets out of bounds. Gabriel does down to about the 16-yard line. You've got Moapa's second-string guys in there now. You can see there's some numbers there we haven't seen all night.
Yeah, they got some subs on the field and getting them some reps, but Hurricane's doing a good job to keep attacking.
Yeah, and you like to see this, some positivity coming out of the offense. Here's Gabriel rolling right, looking right, throwing across the middle, and ooh, that's a dangerous pass in between some defenders there. Falls incomplete.
Yeah, throw the ball late across the middle, bad things happen.
Yeah, well, I'm sure Coach Price have a few words about your quarterback doing that
Back in the day, that would have You'd had a little discussion with Dave Arslanian on the sideline.
You know, it's funny you say Arslanian. I got recruited by Dave out of high school when he was made the head coach after Price left.
Yeah, yeah. Weber State. He's still a St. George guy. He's around here.
Yeah,
I still talk to Coach Arslanian. That's a great football family for sure.
Here's Gabriel rolling right and just getting rid of the ball in time. There's a little chippiness going on now as Gabriel didn't
There's a flag.
Pulled down, but that was number 33, it looked like, for Moapa Valley. No, 23. Kalen Bosch on the pressure there.
They threw a flag on someone.
Gabriel came up chirping a little bit. I don't know if it's on him or if it's on the other guy. But we got 1:52 left here in the fourth quarter. Coach now pulls Gabriel over to the sideline. Looks like it's against
personal
him.
Foul against Hurricane.
And probably giving him a little breather, saying, son, we got to keep our emotions under check. I mean, it's hard, you know. You fight for four quarters, and you do everything you can, and then you get slammed to the ground there at that last play.
Yeah, now it's third and 25, so.
Penalty moves it all the way back out to the 31-yard line. That'll bring in number four at quarterback for Hurricane. That is Burchott, Ryan Burchott. Here's the fake handoff, and now there's a whistle blown. Burchott is a sophomore as well.
Looks like Hurricane called a timeout.
So Coach Ashby wanted to make sure they didn't have anything fall apart on that as they quickly shuffled in a new quarterback, so they took a timeout. So we got 1:51 left here on the clock.
That's going to give him a chance to get Gabriel back in the game. So.
Oh, because they called timeout. You're right. Well, Paul, we've seen some good. We've seen some things that need to be worked on. But we've seen some, I think, some impressive play calling by the Pirates side from Moapa Valley. I think that's really where we saw the difference tonight, is that and the boys up front really took control.
Yeah, the from the kind of the middle of the third quarter on, the Moapa Valley Pirates asserted themselves on the line of scrimmage and took over the game, and that shows on the scoreboard, and that's kind of what happened. But there's no reason for these young Hurricane guys to hang their heads. They stood toe-to-toe with them. They're going to have a lot of good things on film that they can learn from going forward. I mean, the region schedule is coming. This is still a preseason game, so there's a lot
you can learn.
A lot you can learn, and they came out and stood toe to toe with them for at least two quarters. Didn't get the breaks, but like we've said, really since the beginning, a lot of young guys out there, and they're still scrapping. Minute and a half left, and they're still throwing the ball down the field and trying to score points. So.
Well, Gabriel was able to hit Prince down the middle of the field. And here's a throw into the end zone touchdown to Trump, and he's going to get a touchdown.
There it is.
So great throw and catch. A little behind Trump. He was able to adjust. Sophomore to sophomore there. That's a connection I'm sure we're going to hear more and more about.
Yep.
As Trump gets his touchdown, first touchdown of the year.
He's had some really good plays on both sides of the ball tonight, and that was a nice route and a nice catch. Like you said, a little behind him, he reached back and caught the ball with his hands, which is very important. A lot of guys try to catch the ball with their arms, but your arms don't have fingers.
Yeah.
So you want to catch the ball, catch it with your hands.
And you know, as that ball gets into the body, it can bounce up and go anywhere you want.
Yeah, that was a nice catch and a nice touchdown.
So with 1:14 on the clock, that was Gabriel to Trump. You'll see that in the box score tomorrow. Looks like they're going to go for two. Gabriel sends two to the left, and then Staples on his right side. And now we have another whistle, and Moapa Valley is lined up offside, number 24. That's Christopher Piro. He's looking at the ump. He's going, what do you mean I'm offsides? But, yeah, he was offsides.
Yeah. Yeah, you go for two right here and get it, make it 18, you make it a 16, a two-score game. So that's another sign that the coach isn't giving up. He's still
telling the kids, I'm not giving up on you. I'm not.
Still doing the math and saying let's make the smart coaching decisions. And you never know, you know, onside kicks is like a controlled car crash and fun to watch. So.
Yeah, that's the most exciting play in football, I think. Here's the fake handoff and a throw and a nice adjustment by number 80.
And he made the catch. So
that's old,
There's your two-score game, so we will get to watch the onside. And
but a great adjustment again that time by Ramey Olds. You're going to hear that name as well. We've called his name a few times. These young sophomores for Hurricane are making a name for themselves. So that takes us to 34-18 with 1:14 left here in the fourth quarter. Here comes the crash team coming up, as you mentioned.
Oh, yeah, just throw your body in there and see if the ball bounces around the right way.
We used to always tell our kicker in Little League football, it's all about the bounce. We got to get you to at least get it to roll once and pop in
the
air.
Take that big bounce, then you never know, anything can happen.
You know, you can practice it and practice it and practice it, and probably one out of 25 times you can get it to bounce the way you want.
I like that kind of the experiment they did in the NFL that said you can, instead of doing an onside kick, you can take the ball at your own 15-yard line, fourth and 15. You get one play to try to get the ball out to the 30-yard line. If you do, you get a first down. So
I do like that.
Instead of an onside kick. So that's I kind of like that as a one-time-a-game option. You can't do it every time, but once a game you can say, I'm going to take the ball fourth and 15 and see if I can get a 15-yard play. So, well, here they are. They're lined up, though.
They're on the near hash, and here comes the approach. Langston pooches it forward, and, oh, they almost got it. As the defender reached down to pick up the ball, the kicker took him out.
Ball's live under there, and they're pointing. The Hurricane guys are pointing the other way, but I thought I saw a Moapa Valley guy at the bottom of the pile got his hands on the ball. But.
And they are still haven't made a motion as to which way they're going. Looks like it's going to be pirate ball, though.
I don't know. But a Hurricane guy came out with the ball in his hand, so.
Yeah, he came out with it, but I'm thinking they're saying he had it while he was down. You touched him, so they're giving it to Moapa.
Yeah.
They're ready to call it. I think they've had enough fun for one night. But we saw a big hit out of that. That was kind of fun.
You got what you wanted. You want the ball on the ground with a live ball, and your guys with the chance to get it. So
that Langston, he's not a big guy, but, man, he'll lay a lick on you.
Yeah, they haven't. There's no quitting Hurricane Tigers, that's for sure. They have come out and played every snap. They haven't executed as well as they possibly could have, but they have not. There's no quitting them for sure.
Well, there's 1:14 left. A ball on the 48-yard line. They're just going to snap it and take a knee and let the clock run here. And probably only have to snap this thing one more time.
Yeah, get in victory formation. Get ready to go on the bus back to Nevada. And
warm the bus up. Get her rolling. Somebody did call a timeout, though, it looks like. Our producer is wondering why we're doing that this stage of the game, but I think I might be with you, Matt.
That's one of those. I get a little tempted. If I'm the Moapa Valley coach, I call a deep pass right now and say,
okay, you call timeout. I'm going over the top.
You're
going to
call a timeout. I'm going to go. I'm going to go over the top. Man. Make this thing 41-16. So. When my son and I were down at the L.A. Coliseum when the Utes beat the Trojans down there a couple of years ago, and the Trojans did that. They called a timeout late in the game. Kyle Whittingham got a little ticked off and said, oh, yeah, I'm going to throw the ball. And threw the ball for about a 25-yard gain, got another first down, and the USC coaches got the message and just let him run out the clock.
Sometimes coaches have to be reminded, you know, there's a certain way you win, and there's certain and there's a certain way you lose, right? And you wonder why you have some of these things happen on the field. Well, sometimes it's done by the coaches.
Yeah.
So, anyways, here we are, and they take a direct snap in victory formation and kneel down again. So we'll do this one more time, and we'll be done. And there's the final snap
there
of the game.
There it is.
With that said, we will take a quick two-minute break, and then we will come back with our post-game show. after which I'm sure you guys want to hear more of me and Paul talking to you. So we'll be back in 2 minutes for our post-game show here in Tiger Stadium. Final score, Moapa Valley 34, Hurricane Tigers 16. We'll be back right after.
Fabulous Freddy's is the locals' choice for a full-service car wash. It's fast. Have your car washed in just 20 minutes or less. Fabulous Freddy's always keeps it clean inside and out with two Southern Utah locations as well as in Vegas, Lehigh, and Sandy. When it comes to your child's teeth, Dr. Cody and his experienced staff at Johnson Pediatric Dentistry are game changers. So when it comes to checkups, a toothache, or any problem with your kid's teeth, call experienced veteran Dr. Cody Johnson at Johnson Pediatric Dentistry, 628-0511. Own property and want to rent it? Then you need the right team with 11 years of local experience, a staff of over 25 employees, and a 4.9 Google rating. Aim to maximize your rental income and find quality tenants while keeping turnover low to increase your revenue and truly maintain your property. Learn more at redrockpropertymanagement.com.
Yeah.
Had a good second half.
I agree. That's a good choice.
Brody Red.
And we're back live here at Tiger Stadium with our post-game show. We are inside our Region 9 recap show brought to you by Finley Subaru, Fabulous Freddy's, Buck Ace Hardware. Well, Paul, we've had a lot to talk about as that fourth quarter kind of went to a grind, but let's talk about some of our players of the game here. Let me pull this up here real quick. Our post-game show is brought to you by Johnson Pediatric, Dr. Cody. Makes your kids feel right at home. Johnson Pediatrics always has new patients, special cleaning, exams, x-rays for just $79. Call 435-656-0511. Johnson Pediatrics. So, Paul, our first player of the game is our defensive player of the game brought to you by Mountainland Supply. What are your thoughts on our player of the game tonight on the defensive side?
I don't know about defensive player of the game, but I think the defensive play of the game was that screen pass interception by Trey Hershey. He played a really good game, so it was good to have him around. I think
That was the one early in the second
quarter. Yeah, early in the second quarter, I think. And he had a couple hurries on the quarterback, so I think if you're looking at a solid player on the Hurricane side, that he'd probably be my choice.
Okay.
For the player of the game on the defensive side.
So Trey Hershey, number 55, player of the game. Excellent. I think that's a great choice. As you mentioned, that play kind of swung the momentum in the second quarter, kind of got Hurricane back in it. So great call there. All right, here's a tough one. Our playmaker player of the game brought to you by AWP. Who would you go with that one?
A single player or a playmaker?
It could be one or both.
I think the player of the game is, it's pretty clear that was Shannon Matheson, number one.
For the player of the game.
Did everything, punted the ball and ran the ball and scored three touchdowns. So he's the player of the game. And probably he's also made the play of the game when he, on that long drive, when he took that direct snap and kind of scored the back-breaking touchdown.
Yeah.
That really took the air out of the stadium and made it decisive.
So our player, Hurst Ace Hardware, player of the game and the playmaker of the game is going to go to Shandon Matheson from Moapa Valley.
Yeah, I think so.
Okay. How about our dealer collision big hit of the game? Who would you give that to? We saw a few tonight.
Boy, I can't remember the number of the guy that caused the fumble.
Oh, that was Tyson Redd, number four.
Yeah, that was probably the biggest. Left the guy sitting on the bench rubbing his ribs and thinking about things for sure, because that was a heck of a hit.
All right. So that will be Tyson Redd, our defensive big hit of the game. And now our sub of the game. Who would you go with that one?
Now we talked about kind of when Moapa Valley was bringing their subs in the game, the Brody Redd, number 29, came in at running back and subbed out for Matheson and had – were pretty impressive for a young kid, you know.
Young sophomore.
Like we talked about, one of those three or four sophomores that they brought with them that really came in and played well.
I think that's a great call. Well, let me just give a shout-out to a few other sponsors, Intermountain Sports Performance, Intercap Lindy, Handles Ice Cream, I can't thank these sponsors enough. You guys have been fantastic. We appreciate your support, and we've been happy to bring you the game here this week. And we hope you have a great weekend, everybody. So for Paul Valenzuela, this is Keith Curtis signing off. Our final score again was Moapa Valley 34.